Okay, we're going to start in a moment. If folks could quiet down and take their seats. Sergeant, are we ready?
Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Councilmember Corey Johnson. I am chair of the Council's Committee on Health. Thank you for joining us today as we hear Introduction 442, sponsored by Councilmember Ben Kalos. Obesity-related health problems are among the leading causes of death in New York City. Children and adolescents who are obese are more likely to become obese adults, and even young children can develop high cholesterol, high blood pressure, and type 2 diabetes. Although many factors are behind childhood obesity, consumption of restaurant food has been linked with higher risk for being overweight and obese. Research has found that food marketing influences children's food preferences and food choices. This is no secret to fast food chains, many of which market directly to children. The biggest way they do that in terms of money spent is by including toys with children's meals. Although some restaurants have improved the nutrition content of their kids' meals in recent years, few of them appear to meet the standards of Introduction 442. For example, McDonald's now offers fruit alongside the French fries for its Happy Meals. But also offers sugar-sweetened beverages as an option as well. Through a wide range of initiatives, from parental education to calorie counts on menus to replacing soda with water at schools, the city has started to reverse the trend of rising childhood obesity. But we are fighting against powerful forces marketing unhealthy food to children. The bill we're hearing today is an attempt to grapple with this difficult problem. I want to thank you all for being here. I look forward to hearing from health experts, advocates, and the restaurant industry to discuss how we can make progress against the rise of childhood obesity. I want to acknowledge the members who have joined us today. Councilmember Jimmy Vaca is a member of this committee recently, with Councilmember Arroyo leaving. Thank you for being here. And I want to thank my legislative director, Lewis Cholden Brown, the counsel to the Health Committee, David Seitzer, the policy analyst to the Health Committee, Crystal Pond, and I want to give Councilmember Kalos the opportunity to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Chair Johnson, for holding this hearing, and most importantly, for being my co-prime on this legislation, along with Councilmember Steve Levin. With the three of us leading the charge on this, I don't think anyone can stop us from protecting our city's kids. I'd also like to thank Councilmember now State Senator Leroy Comrie for initially introducing this legislation back in 2011, and thank Deputy Commissioner Sonia Angel for joining us today. I'd also like to thank my food policy directors, Amanda Melpolder, now with NYCHA, Leah Eden, now with United Way, and Debbie Vishnesky, who has stepped up to the plate, as well as my legislative director, Paul Westrick, and my chief of staff, Jesse Towson. We've got a whole team dedicated to this, plus many more graduate students who've worked in our food policy shop for quite some time to help make this happen. A 2010 study by the city's Department of Health found that an alarming 40% of public school children ages grades K through 12 were overweight or obese. A 2014 Center for Disease Control study looking at just elementary and middle school age children in New York City public schools showed that despite positive strides, 21% of these children were obese, and another 6% were severely obese. These kids are at a higher risk for diabetes, heart disease, and many other conditions now, and as they grow up. In fact, this means that if we continue down this path, children in New York City will have shorter projected lifespans than their parents. That's not just depressing, that's not acceptable. In 2009, the Federal Trade Commission reported that the fast food industry spent $714 million advertising to children, nearly half of which was highlighting toys that accompanied the meals. This marketing influences the children's preferences. Children, in turn, influence their parents' food purchasing choices. A 2007 study published in the International Journal of Advertising and Marketing to Children showed that children are a significant player in the family food choices. A 2011 study published in the Journal of Marketing Management went even further to show that children are aware of this influence and intentionally use it to over purchases they know they can impact, especially meal choices. The term is pester power. It is real, and we know companies use millions of dollars to influence children who don't have the cognitive ability to make healthy food choices. And we have to stop that cycle. Introduction 442 requires nutritional standards for restaurant meals intended for children, which include an incentive. Or in simpler terms, this bill requires any kid's meal that comes with a toy to also come with some nutritional value. Specifically, the total meal must be 500 calories or less. Fewer than 35% of the calories may come from fat. Fewer than 10% of the calories may come from saturated fat. Fewer than 10% of the calories may come from added sugar. The meals must contain fewer than 600 milligrams of sodium, and the meal must include a full serving of either fruit or vegetables or a serving of whole grains. These guidelines in the legislation are similar to the National Restaurants Association's Kids Live Well program, which aims to help parents and children select healthy menu options when dining out and counts as many as 144 restaurants and chains as partners, including restaurants like Burger King and Wendy's, totaling roughly 42,000 restaurant locations across the country, some of which don't even offer toys, but they do offer a healthy meal. In a 2008 report by CSTI, it was noted that eating out accounts to one-third of children's daily caloric intake. Parents shouldn't have to give up eating at restaurants in order to make sure their child eats a nutritious meal. This bill is about empowering parents trying to feed their kids in an affordable, healthy meal and builds on work of many restaurants have already begun. The goal is to serve more fruits, vegetables, and whole grains to our children so they grow up knowing the importance of making healthy food choices and can avoid the serious health risks associated with poor nutrition. I'd like to thank DOHMH for the work they've done so far to empower parents and children to make healthy food choices, as well as all the advocates who have been working for years to combat childhood obesity and ensure access to affordable and healthy meals for our city's children. Thank you again to our chair, Corey Johnson, and our general welfare chair, Steve Levin, for being co-primes on this legislation and helping to carry this forward.
Thank you, Councilmember Kalos. We've been joined by Majority Leader Jimmy Van Bramer, and I want to call up the administration who is going to testify. We have with us today, as Councilmember Kalos said, Dr. Sonia Angel from the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, Dan Cass from the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, and the General Counsel at the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, Tom Merrill. If you all could please raise your right hand. Do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in your testimony before this committee and to respond honestly to council member questions? So you may begin in whatever order you'd like. Just make sure that the red light on your mic is on.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Chairman Johnson and members of the committee. I am.
If you could just pull it a little closer.
Closer? Is that
there
good?
There you go.
Yeah, great. So good afternoon, Chairman Johnson and members of the committee. I am Dr. Sonia Angel, Deputy Commissioner of the Division of Prevention and Primary Care at the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. I'm joined today by Dan Cass, Deputy Commissioner for the Division of Environmental Health, and Tom Merrill, General Counsel. On behalf of Commissioner Bassett, thank you for the opportunity to testify today on the proposed legislation, which would set nutritional standards for meals that include incentive items appealing to children. I want to note on the outset of my testimony that the law department is still reviewing this bill, so my testimony does not include any possible legal issues the law department may find in its review. The health department shares the council's interest in creating healthier food environments for all New Yorkers, and in particular, we applaud you for thinking about ways to reduce childhood obesity rates. We are concerned, however, that the bill will fail to achieve this goal for a variety of reasons. First, we believe restaurants will not be able to comply with, and the department will not be able to enforce, the bill's requirements. The bill restricts any restaurant from offering a toy or other incentive item unless the meal, food item, or beverage meets certain nutritional standards. The majority of the city's 24,000 restaurants are independent establishments that prepare meals to order for their customers. It would be difficult for these restaurants to determine whether they are compliant with these standards, and it would be impossible for the department to determine compliance. Chain restaurants serve more standardized meals, and by federal law, they will be required to have certain nutritional information on site for customers and the department to reference beginning on December 1st, 2016. The bill, however, imposes standards beyond the information required by federal law. And for these standards, the department similarly will not be able to determine whether a particular meal, food item, or beverage complies with the proposed legislation. Second, the bill's broad definition of incentive creates enforcement problems. First, a meal sold with a toy giveaway is easy to identify. While a meal sold with a toy giveaway is easy to identify, the bill could also apply to meals served on placemats with clown faces, meals that offer children crayons to draw with, or ice cream served in Little Yankees or Mets helmet. Identifying what is and what is not a covered meal would lead to longer inspections and disputes with restaurants, which could eventually require judicial interpretation. Finally, we are also concerned that the bill will have limited reach. The bill would only apply to meals, food items, and beverages with incentive items, which are a small proportion of meals purchased for children in restaurants. According to 2009 data from the NPD Group, a market research company, nearly 80% of meals ordered for children in restaurants are not from a kid's menu. Similarly, a 2015 study conducted in three chain restaurants found that only 35% of children ordered a meal sold with a toy. Thus, the bill's nutrition standards would only apply to a small percentage of food sold by restaurants to children. Also, a restaurant could avoid implementing the nutrition standards simply by not offering incentive items with kids' meals, or by not offering kids' meals, as Taco Bell did in 2013. Given this, the department does not think that this bill would achieve the council's laudable goal of reducing childhood obesity. As I said earlier, however, we are excited to be talking about this issue, and we welcome the opportunity to discuss with you other ways to tackle this problem. The mission of the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene is to improve and protect the health of all New York City residents and promote and protect health equity. Obesity and associated chronic diseases, type 2 diabetes and heart disease, are a significant health problem in New York City and disproportionately affect Blacks, Latinos, and poor New Yorkers. Continued efforts to address these chronic conditions are needed. Two key dietary contributors are high sodium and sugary drinks, the latter being the single largest source of added sugar in Americans' diets. Reducing consumption of sugary drinks is a priority for the department, as consumption of sugary drinks is linked to long-term weight gain and increased risk of heart disease and diabetes. Consumption of sugary drinks by children is especially concerning. With every additional sugary drink a child consumes daily, the odds of becoming obese increases by 60%. In the United States, nearly 50% of added sugar consumed among children and teens come from beverages, and over 40% of New York City children ages 6 to 12 were reported to consume one or more sugary drinks daily. An assessment of children's meals on menus in the top 25 U.S. chain restaurants found that soft drinks are the most popular beverage offered with children's meals. Improving beverage options in children's meals can help improve diet quality, as they are a significant contributor of empty calories to children's diets. These products are also heavily marketed in our communities. In 2013, beverage companies spent $866 million on ads for unhealthy drinks, four times the amount spent on advertising of non-sugar sweetened drinks, like 100% fruit juice and water. Disparities in marketing exposure exist and may impact equity in health among all children. Throughout the United States, Black and Latino TV viewers are overexposed to sugary drink advertising compared to other youth. In 2013, Black youth saw more than twice as many TV ads for sugary drinks and energy drinks compared with white youth. Locally, 85% of food and non-alcoholic beverage ads in supermarkets and bodegas surveyed in South Bronx neighborhoods were for sugary drinks in 2012. Several leading restaurant chains, including McDonald's, Burger King, Wendy's, and most recently Applebee's and IHOP, have removed sugary drinks as a default option from kids' meals. This voluntary action demonstrates that this targeted change is feasible and appealing to consumers. The department agrees that sugary drinks have no place in children's meals and encourages restaurants to offer healthier default beverage choices across their menu options. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Angel, for your testimony. We've been joined by Council Members Peter Koo and Council Member Rosie Mendez, two members of this committee. Before I turn it over to Council Member Kalos, who I know has many questions, it sounds like from your testimony you don't support this piece of legislation in its current form.
That's correct.
That's correct. And you spent a significant amount of time talking about the issues related to sugar-sweetened beverages and the health impact they have in New York City.
Correct.
You gave a lot of statistics. Primarily, I mean, it disproportionately affects Black, Latino, and poor New Yorkers who are marketed these items, who aren't offered healthy options, sometimes in their own communities, and the pretty significant health effects that that has on an individual who is over-consuming sugar-sweetened beverages.
That's right.
So do you support the portion control cap on sugar-sweetened beverages?
So the mayor and this administration has gone on record supporting approaches to reducing sugary beverage intake.
Do you support the portion control cap?
He's gone on record supporting the portion control cap.
He supports that? Yes.
Yes, he has gone on record supporting the portion control cap.
So how do we best achieve that? What is the health department's view on that? If that's the primary issue here, I mean, you spend a lot of your testimony talking about that.
Thank you for this opportunity to talk about sugar-sweetened beverages, because the point is absolutely clear that 40% of added sugar in adults and nearly 50% of added sugar in children and youth is coming simply from sugar-sweetened beverages. There are very, very few nutritional opportunities we have to target one single item that could have such a profound impact on the health of our children and future generations. As noted earlier, this generation faces the likelihood of a shorter lifespan as a result of exposures that kids have these days that we didn't necessarily have as adults. Sugar-sweetened beverages are incredibly important to address. We are looking for ways to address this through many activities, and already we are doing this through specific environments. So, for example, in daycare centers, you're sure you're aware, we introduced regulation that eliminates sugar-sweetened beverages in daycare centers and instead promotes things like water.
Through Board of Health regulations.
That's right.
Yes.
And through this, throughout our schools and through the food procurement standards, we have also put in place mechanisms that reduce exposure not only in youth and children's environments, but adult environments as well, where the city is responsible for purchasing items.
But isn't that tinkering a bit around the edges? I mean, I'm not saying it's not important.
No, it's a really important
point.
But I
don't want to get off of, you know, I want to turn it over to Councilmember Kalos, but since you spent so much of your time talking about this, since it's been in the news, since there was a Court of Appeals case that struck down what the previous administration tried to do, not based on the substance of the policy, but based on jurisdictional issues, that it shouldn't go through the Board of Health, but should go through the City Council, legislative body, what is the Department of Health's plan on, and this is not me discounting the things you just outlined,
right,
but to do something writ large in a wholesale way that will have the most dramatic effect on reducing the intake of sugar-sweetened beverages?
So I would answer that in two ways. Once, I want to note the sugar-sweet beverages do not exist in simply one environment. They're not only in restaurants. Clearly, we buy them in the retail environment. We consume them in the home. We buy them in vending machines. So the solution is not one single solution. The solution really requires us thinking across many of the different environments. The example that you bring up, which is supported by the evidence, was a portion cap approach to use in restaurant environments. that is one of a number of examples that would help increase healthy options, reduce exposure to very high levels of sugar-sweetened beverages, and help promote other options like water and other beverages that might and would have a more healthful outcome.
Go ahead, Tom.
Tom Merrill, the General Counsel, and as you noted, we did go to the Court of Appeals. We do believe in portion cap. It is something we thought should have been done. We lost, as you point out, on jurisdictional grounds, not on substantive grounds. And the mayor is on record as supporting that, and we would support it legislatively, but it's, as you asked us, it's in your ball court now and not ours.
Would you all support banning sugar-sweetened beverages as part of kids' meals?
So one of the important things when we think about policies to introduce is not only the feasibility and likelihood of enforcement, but it would also be the health impact. So I think that is banning them in kids' meals is something that is worth considering. It has been done in one other jurisdiction that we know of.
Where?
In Davis County.
Davis County, California. California.
Yeah.
So goes Davis County, so goes New York City.
Can I quote you on that?
Okay.
So that would be something to explore. We'd be happy to discuss that with you. We would want to look at the health impact that one single policy would have on kids.
We've been joined by Councilmember Matthew Eugene, and I want to turn it over to Councilmember Kalos. I already recognize him. Yes, thank you.
You have a question?
Yeah. Thank you, Chair Johnson. So just to go through the arguments one at a time. Your first argument is it would be impossible for the department to determine compliance because of 24,000 restaurants. How many restaurants are currently evaluated by DOHMH for food grades every year?
So the all restaurants are evaluated and for food grades. The issue was not that we were trying to raise was not that it was the number of restaurants that could be affected. It was the availability of information both at the restaurant level and to the health department to determine whether a food item would meet the requirements, the nutritional requirements, or whether the bundling of food items in a kid's meal would exceed any of these standards. That's the crux of the issue. It's informational as opposed to
yes or no,
resource.
DOHMH currently sends out inspectors to every restaurant in the city to determine health regulations and compliance therewith.
That's correct.
And calories have to be posted. That's something that's already out there.
Calories have to be posted for a subset of restaurants, only for those that are part of a national chain with 15 or more across the country.
And of that 24,000, how many would meet that criteria?
It's about 4,000, I believe.
So 4,000 you already have the calorie counts for?
We have calorie counts, but there are other elements of the requirements here that we don't.
Okay, so you've got calorie counts at least 4,000. Sodium, that's something else in our bill. Are you doing any regulation around sodium?
Yes, I think as you know, we passed new regulations that have gone into effect and will begun to be enforced in March. Those two apply to a subset of restaurants, only to those that are required to post calorie labels.
Okay, so we've got sodium calories checked off. What about...
I'm just going to make a point. We have them checked off for chain restaurants.
And that's the 4,000 restaurants?
That's correct.
Okay, and so next on the list is fat. Have we done anything around fat, trans fats, polysaturated fats, unsaturated fats? Are those things that DOHMH is currently regulating?
We regulate trans fat as an outright prohibition. So the way a restaurant determines whether an item has trans fat is that it's required to be posted on federal nutritional labels. That's how they would determine whether something has trans fat or not. It would require something quite different for a restaurant to determine the total fat content, the percent of calories from fat in a full meal as opposed to an ingredient. And that's part of the concern with this bill, is that that's the expectation. Not just for chains, but for all restaurants, for all bundled meals.
So there's an app for that. Literally, you can go on to the USDA or anywhere else pretty much and look up the caloric count for an egg, for a tomato. Is that correct?
There are, if you were constructing a recipe, then yes, you can actually determine the total fat content, assuming you know everything about what's going into there. There are additional exclusions that this law requires, which would be to exclude from those calculations, for example, nut fats. So that further complicates the matter. Again, I think one of the issues is that, you know, many of the regulations that have been very effective, like calorie labeling, and as we're beginning to launch the sodium warning, that are in chain restaurants, are really predicated on the notion that the restaurants already know. The meal is entirely standardized, is identical across each of the instances of that restaurant or each of the facilities. And I think the reach of this legislation, while, you know, again, we entirely support its goals, but the reach of it into all restaurants and into all potential meals makes it much harder to, both at the restaurateur level and for us to notice.
So would you support the legislation if it was targeted at the 4,000 restaurants that currently have the calorie counting postings? Would that be easier for you to reinforce?
Well, I think aspects, from an enforcement perspective, aspects of this would be easier if were it limited to restaurants that had standardized menus and that make nutritional information available. That doesn't remove some of the other difficulties of this bill around some of the other ingredient requirements and right now the health department is tracking sodium based on disclosed information from chain restaurants. We have the ability to evaluate calories based on disclosed information, and so do restaurants. Were a restaurant only to be required to sum the calories of components of a kid's meal or sum sodium for components of a kid's meal, that would be relatively straightforward, both at the restaurant level and at the and for the department in evaluating it. But once we're getting into, you know, grains, whole or non-whole, total content from certain fats but not others, it becomes much more difficult.
We had the Department of Education here yesterday. They're serving millions of meals, and they seem to be able to do this. It also seems that the National Restaurant Association is able to do this as part of the Kids Live Well program, so it is hard for me to fathom that DOHMH, which is in the business of doing this with calories and sodium and trans fat, would not be able to do it for the others. Second on the bill, you have confusion with regards to incentives, and you actually listed examples of incentives. I would say that whether or not you get something physically when you get a meal as a takeaway is pretty straightforward, and probably as these go, and having read through the USDA's regulations for school food, which was 81 pages just for the regs, and then the subregs were around 151 pages, this bill is 2 pages. So I'm having trouble understanding why the definition of an incentive item is so hard. I can read it to you from the bill if it's necessary.
Well, I think Dr. Angel's testimony poses a question to the council and to the authors of the bill about what precisely is meant. And so it would be helpful if that could be clarified. If the clarification is that any item whatsoever handed out to someone ordering a meal is an incentive, or if then that's helpful to know. But we weren't clear upon reading this whether the example cited placemats, the receptacle for ice cream scoops, counted, or whether this was intended to focus principally on toys, or that kind of thing.
Sure. Can we dispense with the reading? But I think it comes down to placemat type situation where you're throwing it away with the tray and there's no value. That's a piece of paper. If we're talking about a piece of paper with a monopoly number written on it, and you call a number or you go on an app and then you win $1 million. That's clearly incentive. If it's a laminated thing that you're taking home and it's being advertised as a piece, that's different. And then just going back to the first question, you're saying our bill applies to 24,000 restaurants or 4,000 subset, but in your analysis, have you done even an estimate of, before you came out in opposition, did you do an estimate on how many of the 24,000 restaurants in New York City offer a toy bundled with kids' meals, or even just restaurants with kids' meals in New York City?
The reality is we don't know that information. It's not something we've gathered before. And I think it would take some work to determine it, and it would also be quite, there would need to be more than one snapshot in time, because kids' meals may be offered at one time in a restaurant or in a chain and not again for another period of time. So we don't actually know how many restaurants offer kids meals at any time, nor do we know the frequency with which those that do, do.
Honestly, before I come out with a position on things, I generally try to learn as much about the underlying facts as possible. So I think it's worth the time, and I would like, will DOHMH look at these numbers and come back with what the numbers are here and how many restaurants you actually think this applies to and give us a second opinion, as it were, perhaps from a different doctor at DOHMH, of how easy this would be to enforce? Can I get a second opinion?
I get it. So I don't think we can commit to surveying restaurants to do this. I think we'd be dependent on any information we've heard from national surveys on the the frequency with which kids' meals are offered, and then we don't know, we probably know less the extent to which those include incentives. You might ask some of the industry representatives who may be here today how frequently it's done, but it would be a very heavy workload to do a survey to determine it.
If you ask your numbers folks at DOHMH to go through your open data set with the food grades, I can instruct them on matching those up. On the third piece of opposition, your concern is that this is only for meals with incentive items. Would Mayor de Blasio support applying this to all children's meals?
So absolutely, the concern about the incentive items also stems from the fact that we know that in one study, for example, where they looked at three major restaurants, about 35% of the meals purchased by kids were those that included toys. We also know from the NDP data that I quoted earlier that 80% of the meals ordered by children are not from the kids' menu. And so that means only about 20% of kids are ordering from that kids' menu. What we would need to do is take a step back and look at this again and analyze it within the context of the very limited number of restaurants that this would apply to, as we're discussing, that are standardized restaurants, and the number of children that would be anticipated to be purchasing off of the kids' menu. We need the criteria of the toys food in order for us to assess some level of impact. We'd be happy to discuss with a new iteration of a bill, because that's not the bill that we were commenting on here. If there's a new iteration, a way in which it would be shaped, we'd be more than happy to discuss with you the impact that we have. But the final assessment for us in making a recommendation about going forward would be the impact that would have on children's purchasing of more healthy meals.
To be clear, and in terms of scope, amendments to a bill are generally what you suggest prior to coming out in opposition. So if you would like to do the study and give us as part of that second opinion, whether you believe we could have a better impact, that would be great. And that would have been within the bounds of this hearing to come to your hearing and say, we're opposed to this bill, but we want a sugar drink ban. We want to ban sugary drinks. I think that's actually usually out of scope. And I think, as you've answered for the chair, the mayor wants a sugary drink ban.
So I appreciate what you're saying. The question is how one would look at limiting or increasing healthier options being purchased in restaurants so that it had a maximum impact. So we are very supportive of policies that improve the nutritional environment, the restaurant environment for dining for all New Yorkers, and we're very interested in ways in which we might improve the purchasing of meals for children as well. So we're happy to look at this with you, but the concern
I would encourage the mayor. He's introduced a number of program bills. He is welcome to introduce a bill specifically on sugary drinks, but I would note that as part of this legislation, when a sugary drink is offered as part of, for free or nominal price, as part of another offering to a child, it does limit calories from sugar or caloric sweeteners. So do you think that would help with this larger problem that you're saying 40% of New York City children ages 6 to 12 are reported to consume one or more sugary drinks daily?
So I think there are many different ways to approach the sugary drink issue.
Well, you've got a live bill on the table. You don't have a sugary drink bill coming or that the mayor's introduced. This one's been here for 2 years. You haven't done any of the analysis prior to coming out in opposition. So would this help towards your goal that you spent a page and a half of your testimony on?
So the subset of consumers that would purchase it that we understand would purchase it based on this data would help, but whether or not that would have a long-term meaningful impact is really looking at how many of those consumers that there would be. As mentioned also in my testimony, there are a number of chain restaurants which have already changed the default for sugary drink on their kids' meals that come with the incentivized toys. So again, it's looking at not only it's looking at where things are right now and including looking at your nutritional requirements, understanding how many are already being met to understand what kind of impact it will have otherwise.
We're going to come back to Councilmember Kalos in a little while. I want to get to some of the other members that have questions. First, we're going to go to Councilmember Vaca.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair. So much of what I wanted to ask or say has been said. I do want to indicate to you that I think that we should use the bully pulpit in this city more effectively. I come from the Bronx. We are 62 out of 62. We are the most unhealthy county in the entire state. And it's a distinction that we're not happy with. Something must be done. I just looked up something, and I don't want to say what restaurants, what fast food place it comes from, because I don't go to those places. But chicken bacon sandwich has 38 grams of fat, in excess of 1,700 milligrams of sodium, 65 carbohydrates, 10 saturated fat. So this is typical, I think. And my suggestion to you is that we start to get a target. What is our city's objective? And then call in 10 or 15, the fastest of the fast food restaurants, and let them know that they've got to be part of the solution. Get them around the table and let them know that this can't continue to exist in this city. We have to tell people that we want accountability. And no one's being called to task on this. I think someone has to be called to task. What are we doing about that? Why can't we ask these people to come to the table and tell them that they have to get their shop in order?
So I think this comment of engaging industry meaningfully and actively into changing menus is a really important discussion to have. You may know about the National Salt Reduction Initiative, in which we set targets for sodium reduction. In setting those targets, we included industry in the conversation to set the targets and ask them to commit to them. We're evaluating the impact that that's having, and so we have, to your point, started those discussions. They can be expanded. And I think it's a really important note that we are all part of the solution and we all need to work together on this.
Yeah, I think they have to be formalized. I think it's got to be publicly announced that this is an objective. There's got to be a mobilization of citizens in the city behind your efforts. It can't be done quietly and piecemeal. I don't see this effort right now. I don't see any such effort. Whatever you were doing quietly is even news to me as a councilman, leave alone the average person who's not involved in the legislative process. So I think that we have to go at this full throttle, and I just don't see it. This is an emergency. We have an emergency. We have an emergency. In my borough especially, we have an emergency, and people talk about it and people write about it, yet there's no concerted citywide target. There's no, what are we looking for? How much fat can we reduce? How much sodium should we be reducing? Everyone has to be involved. You know why? When you reduce the fat and the sodium, sometimes the taste will suffer, will not taste the same. So perhaps one or two of them will not want to do that. They may lose customers from it. That's why everybody's got to be engaged. Maybe we have to sacrifice taste a little bit in order to get health. You can go almost anywhere and get a grilled option. You can get grilled vegetables, grilled chicken. Many of these places have a grilled option full of sauces, full of breads. It's not really a grilled option. It's full of everything else that's junk. So when are we going to have a real grilled option for our kids, for our adults? So I bring this up to you. I'd be willing to help you in that effort, but We need a commitment. We need the city to say that this is something that you're going to undertake at the highest levels. And that's my statement.
Thank you very much.
Councilmember Koo.
Thank you, Chair Johnson, and thank you, Dr. coming to testify. You mentioned in your testimony obesity has a higher prevalence in the minority population. So how big a problem for the minority, compared with the American white kids, what's the percentage? Well, compared with the general population.
So the data I have for children is actually, we have it broken down by district public health offices, but which, as you know, in New York City, we definitely have race-ethnic differences by our neighborhoods. So I'll share for you some statistics that show the differences in school children, ages kindergarten through eighth grade. So overall, the level of obesity in New York City kids is 21.4%. One in five children are obese in our
city. Yeah.
And when we look at the Bronx, 24.8%, one in four.
Okay.
When we look at Brooklyn, our district public health office there, again, one in four, 24.8%. East Harlem, 24.7%. If you do not live in those neighborhoods, the average prevalence is 20.3%. And I'd be happy to look back at some data that we have by race, ethnicity, and we can get back to you on those numbers. But I think those numbers that I've just shared with you really illustrate the gross disparities that we have in our communities, especially when you recognize that being obese as a child doubles the likelihood of you being obese as an adult.
So from your professional knowledge, do you think these kids are obese because they eat too many Happy Meals or for other reasons?
So the causes of obesity include excess caloric intake with not enough burning off of energy, right? You take in too much, you don't burn off enough. So it's a combination of eating too much and not exercising enough, that's striking that balance. And we know that in particular, the foods that we're eating, the choices that that children have and that are being made by themselves or by their parents are not necessarily the most health promoting. The contributors to that depend upon where the child eats and what decision the child makes in that environment. So we know that people are eating out more and more, our lives are more and more complicated, and foods prepared away from the home, and processed foods, are becoming an increasing part of the diet. And so the restaurant environment is one source of caloric and dietary intake that is contributing to obesity in children.
So do you agree with my thought is the all these problems, the main responsibility belong to the family, to the parents, grandparents, how they feed their children, not from us passing a law. Do you agree with that? I mean, the main responsibility lie on the families. That means parents or grandparents, whoever taking care of the kids. They should have to say what the children should eat, and also they drink.
So one of the things that we know and are very committed to is creating healthier environments that empower people to make healthier choices.
Yeah.
The choices that people make, that families make, that children make, that parents make for their children, also depends upon what's available to them. So what we really think about doing with all of the policies and programming that we get engaged in is creating ways in which people can live healthier lives because they're surrounded by more healthful options and opportunities.
So how much calorie the children eat from how much total calories, say, per day or per week from the eating convenient places like McDonald's? How often they go out to McDonald's, once a week or once a month? Do you know that?
I don't have that statistic off the top of my head. I'm sorry.
So my point is that the kid is obese because they eat too many Happy Meals. Because, like you said, they don't have proper nutritional guidance from the parents, or they don't have enough exercise. So there's two things that we should stretch on the Department of Health to teach our neighborhood people how to eat right, how to exercise more, and make sure the parents understand the consequences of drinking too much soda, eating too much potato chips, all those things. I don't think it's necessary for us to pass a law or regulation to tell parents, oh, you shouldn't go to McDonald's to get a Happy Meal. This is we are based on a free market system here. We should not tell business owners that, hey, you cannot give a toy when you sell a meal. I mean, we can tell them certain regulations, the guidelines, hey, if you eat too much sodium, it's not good for you. Too much sugar is not good for you. But I think it's not right for the city to enforce or to pass a regulation or to tell kids that you shouldn't get a Happy Meal for your kid. Or you tell the business owners that you cannot sell a meal by offering an extra toy. I mean, they do in all other businesses to offer something extra. Incentivize that they buy the meal. But I don't think this is illegal or immoral. It's up to the parents who to make the decision.
Well, I appreciate what you're saying, and there's no question that choice is sort of essential in the overall equation of sort of how a child or an adult, for that matter, consumes, you know, excessive calories. That said, you know, even what you're describing requires a set of expectations and a set of and enabling information to be able to make a proper choice. So the basis for calorie labeling requirement, for example, is to inform people. Without that information, there's simply no way someone could make a determination about what food has an appropriate or inappropriate level. The same is true for the sodium warning. Without alerting people who are making the choice. But I think it's also important to note that while we have, you know, very substantive issues with this particular version of this law about because of how difficult it is to obtain this information or enforce on it, I don't think we want to go on record as objecting to the notion that rules and regulations actually do influence practice. Children didn't become obese over the last several decades. Yeah. You know, from simply a lack of information. They've been assaulted with ads, with food choices, with food options, with default options that really really work to promote excessive calorie consumption. That it is the job of government to help sort of balance that kind of activity, that kind of power.
So I would encourage you to work with the school system, to teach, especially while we have universal PK, to teach them how to eat a proper diet when they are young. Teach them that these things are not good for you, these things are good for you, and teach them how to read the label on the food, how much sodium, and all those things. Education is the most important key. So the legislation or the things you want to do are only for, it's good for informational purpose. They can compare, a can of soup, this can has too much sodium and too much. We shouldn't consume so much calories from sugar. Those things, we should teach them, especially in the school level. And the younger they are, the better we teach them. So we should start with universal PK to teach them what's good and not good. So when they grow up, they can make their own choice. I don't think it's this rule, this legislation is an overkill. Overreach to do and from the point of small business people. If I open a restaurant, I don't want to have all these rules in front of me, how many calories from this, how much fat when I cook a meal. It's too much burden. I mean, for a McDonald's, for a big franchise, they probably can do it. But small businesses, mom and pop store or restaurant, they have to follow all these rules, it's difficult. I mean, let the consumers be aware of what they eat. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Koo. Thank you for telling us how you really feel. I think you heard from Councilmember Kalos that he stands, I don't want to speak for him, but it sounded like from what he said, sort of ready, willing, and able to work with the department on amending this bill. And I understand his frustration. And I don't know if there were conversations that were had between the council member and the health department leading up to this hearing.
Yes.
So if that's the case, I think he's justified in saying that before you come out and oppose this bill, and given that you named other instances that the department has undertaken to try to work on some of these obesity issues, childhood obesity issues, that you try to work with him and make the bill suitable, besides before coming and saying outright opposition to it. I want to come back to what I was trying to hit on earlier, which is, and I think Councilmember Kalo has just mentioned this, you know, we haven't seen any action here at the council related to portion control legislation on sweetened sugary beverages. I would like to see that happen. I'm supportive of figuring out how we can make an impact to save people's lives, to ensure they don't get diabetes, to try to provide healthier options, and to incentivize people making healthy choices. But the mayor has, I'm glad he's come out in favor of this. I think he said it during his campaign, and he said it again since then. Do you know, are there any plans to do a program bill or a bill at the request of the mayor on this, given that I know that the health department feels so strongly about this? Do you have any sense?
I mean, I don't have an immediate sense. It's obviously an issue. You know where we stand.
Yeah.
You know? And it's certainly something we're willing to talk about. But I, you know, and as we are on any issue, a lot of issues, and this bill as well. We did speak with Councilman Kalos a year ago. We did raise that we had some enforcement issues. Not in the details perhaps that we should as of today, but we're willing to talk to the administration, to the council rather, about portion cap, anything that can tackle the issue of childhood obesity.
Well, I'm really glad that the mayor came out in favor of this during his campaign and has continued to say he supports it. Commissioner Bassett has been a real leader in talking about these issues and the health impact that it has on communities across the city. And I actually think, and not that it's about politics, but it's actually probably not the most popular position to take, that you'd support putting portion control on this. And the mayor did that and has stood by that. And so I think that is commendable. What I would love to see happen, and we've had many conversations with this, I've had conversations with Dr. Bassett and your team at the department about how we can actually make that happen in a feasible way that would withstand legal scrutiny, as well as hopefully get public support when we explain it well enough on why we want to take this measure. So I just want to get back to, so the position, Dr. Angel, you're saying you would support what Davis County did, a ban on sugary beverages for these type of meals? Would the department support that? You mentioned it in your testimony, but it didn't say we support this goal or we would like the city of New York to take this course of action.
So what we would need to do is look at the impact that would have. We have not done that analysis. If we'd have to be very clear on what kinds of meals this would cover, we would absolutely be willing to discuss this, absolutely interested to think about what the impact might be, share our knowledge on it, and think about revisions that would make sense, that could have impact, that would have impact on children.
And Tom, is it your opinion that you believe that if we took that action under state law and city law, that would pass legal muster?
5 minutes.
You know, you may not know at this point.
The soda one.
If we did it legislatively.
Certainly legislatively, there's one challenge that you don't have to worry about that we had to worry about. I can guarantee you that one. And I think that sitting here, I think that there are some issues around, you know, you have to think about the First Amendment when you're ever talking about promotions and things like that, but I think you could reasonably restrict it, as Davis County did, soda.
Davis City.
Yeah. Davis City.
Okay. Are there any other colleagues that you have questions, Councilmember Kalos? I'm going to go back to Councilmember Kalos. Does anyone have any questions? Anything else? Okay, back to Councilmember Kalos. Jimmy's hungry. Okay, go ahead.
I think I just want to acknowledge some of the remarks that were made by Councilmember Vaca. And in terms of the leadership that we're seeing, we are seeing the National Restaurant Association creating this Kids Live Well program, and Burger King is a participant, Wendy's is a participant, and they're doing this national convening, and there's 144 chains that have agreed to offer a healthy meal, not quite as healthy as our legislation, but pretty damn close. So to the extent, has DOHMH had any conversations with the National Restaurant Association around bringing this to more restaurants in New York City in order to lead, as Councilmember Vaca suggested?
You know, we meet on a frequent basis with the local chapter and the state chapter of the National Restaurant Association, but to our knowledge, this question hasn't come up.
In follow-up to Councilmember Vaca, would you commit to working with the National Restaurant Association around Kids Live Well, if not legislation like ours, and seeing what we can do with them? I mean, they're already leading the nation.
We absolutely are willing to talk to them and hear more about the program. What you're describing is a voluntary program, is that correct?
Voluntary, it's got 144 restaurants. Theirs is 600 calories, ours is 500. So maybe they would be willing to do a Kids Live Well in New York City ahead of our legislation passing so that folks can get to where they need to voluntarily. In terms of the calories from fat, saturated fat, they have almost identical. They allow trans fats, we don't, and that's already banned in New York City, so that's pretty much a non-starter, that's easy. Calories from sugar and other items. So we're pretty close, it's just 100 calories here and 100 milligrams of sodium there. So using what they've already got, and they've already got great restaurants like Burger King, Wendy's. They don't have McDonald's. I don't know why, but they don't have McDonald's, but we do have Burger King, Wendy's, Arby's, Dairy Queen, speaking of places where you can get that baseball cap with ice cream in it. You can even get a Kids Live Well meal at Dairy Queen, of all places. And not that I would want to take away those fun hats. I was a kid once, and they're great, but would love to do that. And I just want to say Deputy Commissioner Cass, I loved your responses to my colleague, Councilmember Koo. We have fond respect for each other, though sometimes we may disagree a little bit. And I think just a key thing to share is just no ban here. Parents can still do whatever they want. It's just, as DOHMH shared, when there's doing these ads, and I guess one question is, how much does DOHMH currently spend on advertising in order to incentivize children to make better choices? Children and adults, or children if you have it, because I see those Subway ads sponsored by you every day.
I'm sorry, I don't have the budget numbers for you, but as you know, we have a couple of campaigns pouring on the pounds and other ones focusing on eating well. We can look back at those budget numbers for you.
But I think as we do this, we're trying to combat all the hundreds of millions of dollars. I think it's somewhere around $350 million as of the Federal Trade Commission that I cited in my opening, that's being spent advertising to children so that those children, because they want the toy, take it back to their parent and drag them by the sleeve, because I was one of those kids, saying, I want that meal because I really want that toy, and the only way to get that specific toy, I can't buy it at a toy store, is if I eat this food, which is really bad for me. And trying to decouple it so that when the kid is dragging them for that toy, that it's a healthy meal.
I'm happy to have a free-willing debate here at the council. The fireworks, we don't typically do this. Councilmember Koo or Vaca, did you want to say something?
I want to agree with my colleague, Councilmember Koo. I do not think that us extending the arm of government, telling someone that you can't have a toy if you buy a certain meal, is going to assist in the very laudable goal I think we all have. And I don't think that we want to do that. And I, on the council, have said this on several occasions, as recently as last week when we had legislation that told supermarket owners you can't fire anyone for 90 days. I voted against that because, again, it's the arm of government coming in and telling a private sector person, you can't do this. We tell you who you can hire and fire. The toy on a different level is kind of similar, and I see, and I agree with Councilman Koo's point, but this conversation, I'm glad we're having it, and I'm glad Councilman Kalos and Chair Johnson have allowed this discussion to take place. I don't see a policy here. I don't see an effort. I don't see any type of coordinated, collaborative program. We are the city of New York. We should be sitting down with every agency. You're the Department of Health. Well, where's the Department of DYCD? Where is Department for Aging? Where is the Department of Education? Where is there a sense of urgency here? I mentioned before about getting together all the restaurants. Where is there a multi-pronged attack? We all sit here with statistics. Believe me, I know that one person in four in the Bronx is obese. I see it. I see it. So, but I don't get any coherent policy here. I don't see anything. Where is the, we need someone to focus on this. We need to have a focus. We focused on cigarette smoking in this city, and we decreased cigarette rates maybe 5 years ago, 6 years ago when we started. And I have to be honest, when I saw those commercials, some of them frightened me. When I saw people dying in front of me on the TV screen. But there was a sense of alarm. There was a sense, oh my God, there's no sense about this. There's no urgency here. I don't sense any coordinated program, multi-agency, nothing.
So I think we share your concern that there is an urgency to respond to this, absolutely. I would share, however, there are examples where we are working across agencies and some very specific, concrete proposals and executive orders have come out of it that have actually set New York City as a leader for the nation at large around food procurement standards. So this is one example. The City of New York has a food policy coordinator, which worked across every single agency. The Department of Health was a technical agency that helped to create nutrition standards so that every single dollar purchased by New York City that is used or that purchases food food to be served or given to individuals has to meet specific nutrition criteria. That covers 260 million meals in New York City per year. That is a huge and immense amount. And it has set an example that's been adopted by other cities and states and even agencies within the federal government coordinating.
I don't doubt your sincerity, but where do we go from here? We've done certain things. Obviously, with the statistics you cited before, we've not done enough. So where do we go from here? What is the vision? What is the plan? And that's what I don't see. I'm not saying that what we've done in the past was not correct. I'm sure it was, and it was helpful. But I don't see any plan for the future.
So we would be happy to sit down and also speak with you further about additional opportunities that exist. We are committed to an approach that does work across all of our agencies because there is this power of the City of New York at large, and it's not one single agency. And in fact, the industry, as you mentioned, is also an important player in this. So we really do appreciate that we need to do.
I will sit down with you at any time.
Sure.
Let me clarify. Let me be very clear. The mayor has made mental health a priority by virtue of the First Lady doing so much for mental health. She has given vision and voice, and I'm proud of that voice. We have no such voice when it comes to public health at this point in New York City. We need a focus on this, be it an individual, a set of individuals, a mayor's commission, perhaps, on health, nutrition, and physical fitness. We need a focus. I will sit down with you, but I shouldn't be sitting down with you absent a plan. And I don't see a plan. I don't see a multi-agency effort. I don't see an urgency. I don't see it. And I want to tell you, I thank Corey Johnson for bringing Ben Kalos' bill to a hearing, even though I'm not on the bill, I'm not for it, but at least there was this conversation, and both of them should be commended for this discussion. But I'm not satisfied that I see what I should see. As a Bronx person, as a city elected official, I'm not happy today.
Was the Department of Health at the hearing yesterday that Councilmember Kalos mentioned related to the Department of Education and looking at food policy?
The Department of Health was not there. Barbara Turk from the Mayor's Office of Food Policy was there.
Why wasn't the department there? Maura, if you want to testify, you can. You can sit down.
I would be happy.
Okay. If you could introduce yourself for the record, and do you affirm to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and answer council member questions honestly?
I do.
Thank you.
And my name is Maura Canelli, and I'm the director of intergovernmental affairs for the health department. Yesterday's hearing was attended by the Department of Education and by the Mayor's Office of Food Policy, represented by Barbara Turk. The Health Department, as Sonia mentioned, is a provides technical assistance to the Office of School Food, but the Mayor's Office of Food Policy really leads kind of the school food initiative across for the administration, and brings together all of the city agencies. When we look at the food standards, the procurement standards that Sonia mentioned.
I love Barbara Turk. She has done amazing service to our city for decades, and I was so happy when the mayor appointed her to that position because she is so capable and able and passionate on these issues. How many staff members work in that office?
I believe that there are 2 full-time staff members.
So the reason why I say that is because, as I say constantly, we have the best Department of Health and Mental Hygiene in the country. I think we have the best commissioner related to public health in the United States. Barbara's amazing. This is not me taking anything away from her. But she has a lot of things to look at. You know, she's 2 people can't do all this work that Councilmember Vock is talking about and that Councilmember Kalos brought up. I mean, Councilmember Kalos has a bill related to this that hopefully we'll have a hearing on sometime soon to try to expand this portfolio and get more support on food policy issues. But I make the point that, and this is not me being critical of the department, I think it's an issue that we see all the time with city agencies and departments, is collaboration and coordination and informing decisions that are made that impact other agencies that sometimes may have more expertise. I mean, we had the hearing a few months ago about, you know, my thoughts on trying to have an Office of Citywide Comprehensive Health Policy, health planning, and it's for the sort of the same reason, which is wanting just to make sure that when the Department of Education comes and testifies on this important issue, when Dr. Angel gives all these, you know, statistics, which I'm sure they had yesterday, hopefully, that the Department of Health is at the table. Because you guys are the real experts on this. You guys are the ones that know this inside and out. You're the doctor. You're the one that has this information. And so I just think we need to do a better job of coming up with a plan and a vision and a task force or a commission or some body that doesn't put it all on Barbara. She does so much, and she has done so much already in 2 years. But I just want to ensure that we continue to coordinate in a real way and come up with a real plan.
Thank you, and we appreciate your thoughts and Councilmember Vaca's, and I think that you've given us a lot to think about, and we will think about that very carefully, and we look forward to talking with you further.
Councilmember Cornegy.
Thank you, Chair. I just would like to offer 2 perspectives of my own. One is as the Chair of the Committee on Small Business. What I've watched is the entire food industry begin a trend of healthy options across the board. And I think that is informed by what consumers demanded, not by government's input, right? Number one. Number two, for once, my opinion on a bill was informed very locally by my family, my 6 children, which we had a discussion about their eating habits and all of the chains, and my twin 8-year-olds were able to describe to me that they now take the milk and water option. They don't drink soda anymore, and the fruit. They love the apples. So, so for me, I'm in my household attempting to raise critical thinkers about what they do, and I think as a society, I'd like to think that it's reasonable for consumers to be able to have a determining factor in what they eat, drink, live, and all of those kinds of things. And so For me, those two perspectives, I think, are very important. You know, I don't often let my family shape my opinion on legislation, trust me. But this one was very germane to how they lived their lives. Now, I will take into consideration the fact that my last children are 8 and potentially aging out of wanting to have a toy. And until there's apps present, you know, probably for them, it's irrelevant. So I do understand that, but they're aging out at a time that the industry is changing. So, you know, I'm watching just the industry at large make determinations driven by what consumers' demands are, not government. So that's my opinion for the record.
Thank you, Councilmember Cornegy. Councilmember Koo.
Thank you, Chair. I just want to make sure that Councilmember Cable said that I'm not against this bill 100%. I commend his intention of bringing obesity to be a talking topic among our citizens, because obesity is really a big problem. So I'm thinking the Department of Health can do a lot of things, you know, to decrease obesity working in conjunction with other agencies. We have to make sure our kids exercise, because now some schools, they don't even have playgrounds. There are no exercise, no PE classes. You know, and then because of the advance of technology, everybody is glued to their cell phone or their wherever the smartphone or a tablet to watch movies or whatever, right, the message. So we have to encourage people, especially young kids, to exercise more, make it a routine for them. Not only especially in the minority neighborhood, because they don't have the understanding, exercise is the key. If you exercise a lot, you can eat whatever you want. Yeah, if you exercise a lot. That's the key. You know, so we have to inform and make sure that you guys and Department of Education and all the other agencies, DVICD, do more exercise and then teach the public about the side effects of drinking too much sugar. Now, if you want to pass a law like this, we might as well pass a law to say, Starbucks, you cannot sell the frappuccinos. No, too much calories in there, right? Too much sugar. You know, an average large size of frappuccino has a lot of calories.
I don't shop at Starbucks. Yes.
Yeah. So my point is that we shouldn't legislate people's habits, because those are cultures. I mean, we can inform them, or we can teach the young kids so that when they grow up, they know what's good nutrition, what's bad nutrition. So that's my point. Thank you. Thank you for coming here, and then hopefully we can work together on other projects, how to inform the public. This is good. You bring up the subject. Everybody talk about it. You know, a happy meal, you know? But we shouldn't target McDonald's. If you want to target McDonald's, you might as well do it for everyone. No giveaways. Macy's, they all have giveaways.
Macy's?
Right? They buy this, get this.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
One thing, Corey.
Cornegy, then Vodka.
I'm sorry, the last thought that I would like to say is that I believe I would err on the side of a very robust, continued education and outreach program as opposed to the legislation. I think that one of the things I had the pleasure of working with the Department of Health on a very robust outlet density study that we did, and it produced great results and used great imagery and really helped. We live in a tremendously visual society. I think we all know that. So I would err on the side of more education as opposed to being punitive or targeting small businesses as were mentioned. So for me, education is key, and education and options and a holistic approach to this. I think it was mentioned earlier that we don't have enough PE or opportunities for exercise, and that's almost like an afterthought. So to try to, you know, this all has to go hand in hand. So thank you, but thank you for being here. And thank you, Chairs and Ben, for this very important topic.
Thank you, Councilmember. Councilmember Vaca.
I want to join in thanking everyone, thanking the panel.
More people to testify after this.
I know, I'll be here. But one thing, I wanted to say that we have to include in our education effort that people cannot think that as long as they exercise, they can eat whatever they want. They cannot. They cannot. Because diet is two-thirds of the battle. Exercise is great. It works. Don't get me wrong. I exercise. But the thing is that you have, the diet is very important, short-term and long-term. Cholesterol, health, blood pressure, et cetera. So salt, we have to emphasize that. So I think what we're trying to say is that we want to work with you. So, but let's get going soon, okay?
Thank you very much.
This week is week four of this season of The Biggest Loser, FYI. Councilmember Kalos.
Just a point of clarification. I think the enforcement issues were not brought up during our last meeting, but one thing I will just echo a lot of my colleagues' point, we're 755 days in. We have fewer days left in the administration than we did before. We have 705 days left. And so I think one of the things that I was always raised with is don't knock something unless you've got a better idea. So and I think everyone has already asked this, but does DOHMH have a better idea than trying to make sure that we tie incentive items or even just all kids' meals to nutrition guidelines?
So we're pleased to meet with you to discuss through what the options would be.
Okay, I think what you're hearing from the entire health committee is we want to see something very serious, substantive, that will take on this obesity crisis. I think given the high rates of childhood obesity and the emergence of type 2 diabetes among children in New York City, why are soda and other sugar-sweetened beverages still on kids' menus at the overwhelming majority of our restaurants?
I mean, the simple reason they're on the menu is because the restaurants are currently entitled to offer whatever they want. Again, you know, we approach this bill with, you know, sympathetic to its goals. We agree that sugar-sweetened beverages are an unnecessary and leading source of excessive calories for children, and we'd be happy to work with you to try to think of some other solutions.
And I think I've been speaking a lot about it. The National Restaurants Association's Kids Live Well program and individual companies' efforts have resulted in modest improvements to restaurant kids' meals. Progress has been slow, according to data from the Center for Science in the Public Interest. In 2008, 1% of kids' meals were healthy. In 2012, that number had only improved to 3%. Without this legislation, when can New York City parents expect that most kids' restaurants will actually have a healthy option?
I appreciate the question. I think we have to say that, you know, we're happy to work with you to find some alternatives.
And I think just my final question is, in light of the fact that children consume about 25% of their calories from restaurants and that childhood is a critical time for growth and development, and even from your own report, 35% of those meals are kids' meals, how do we target those meals? I feel like that's a sizable number. In your report, you seemed to say only a third of meals, but oh my God, that's a lot of kids. That's 20% of our city, and 25% of those calories are coming from restaurants, and we have an opportunity to target 35%. That's hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of meals and kids. So are people we want to give a healthy option, right?
I mean, it's a third of a quarter in terms of the overall.
And when we're talking about scale, 1/6 of our city,
yep.
That's huge.
But I think, you know, as you give us an opportunity to think about and to discuss more with you options, you know, the kind of kids' meals are a component. Mm-hmm. One consequence of some of this legislation might be simply to eliminate the incentive without necessarily changing the makeup of the kids' meal. So I think we'd like to talk to you about, you know, the best possible way to influence each component of a kid's meal and the kid's meal itself.
Good. I look forward to having you all engage with Councilmember Kalos. What's a reasonable time frame? Reasonable, realistic, and not solely addressing Councilmember Kalos's bill. I look you all will communicate with him about that in whatever way is best. But in actually coming up with a comprehensive plan and what council members have raised today related to obesity and childhood obesity and cross-agency coordination, maybe it's already happening, but we don't know it. What's a realistic time frame for you to come back to the council and present that to us and for us to continue to have those conversations?
So I think that there is already a lot of work that the department is doing that, but from what we hear from you guys today, maybe we're not doing as good of a job as we would like to promote that work. So I think that we can schedule a meeting in the next few weeks to talk through with you what we're currently doing and what our plans are for the future, if that works well for you.
Great. So I want to thank you all for coming today, for being here. Thank you, Dan, Dr. Angel, Tom, and Maura for being here. We appreciate you coming to testify and look forward to working together on shared goals. Thank you very much. Okay, we're going to call the next panel up. The next panel, we're going to get to everyone, so don't worry. Brian Elbel from the NYU School of Medicine, Dr. Marie Bragg from the NYU School of Medicine, Kimberly Libman from the New York Academy of Medicine, Nick Freudenberg from the CUNY School of Public Health, and Dr. Charles Platline from Hunter College. So, Sergeant, we're gonna put the folks testifying on a 3-minute clock. So if you all could, I'm sure there'll be questions. So if you can't get to everything in your testimony, you may have an opportunity to inject some of what you weren't able to cover in the Q&A portion of this panel. So you may begin in whatever order you'd like. If you could just speak clearly into the mic, with the, make sure the red light is on. Did we get everyone? Is someone not here? Dr. Charles Platline? Sorry. Nick Freudenberg? No. Is Nick Freudenberg here? Okay, you all may begin.
Great. Good afternoon, Chairman Johnson, Councilman Kalos, and members of the committee. My name is Brian Elbel. I'm an associate professor in the Department of Population Health at NYU School of Medicine and also at the Wagner School of Policy here at NYU. And I direct the section on health choice policy and evaluation. And most of my work looks at obesity, and particularly looks at food choice in relation to obesity. And I'm happy to talk to you today about this bill. You know, since my appointment at NYU in 2007, I have a broad set of funding from the NIH and key foundations to answer very similar questions to this, including things like the impact of calorie labeling, supermarkets in high-need areas, and the overall role of the food environment on childhood obesity. And today I'm going to outline the potential health benefits of this ordinance, number 422. And more specifically, look at the potential reduced consumption of things like calories, sodium, and percentage of calories if this bill were to be implemented. And I should say that this paper is joint with Marie Bragg, who you're going to hear from separately, and you already heard it referenced by Sonia Angel from the Department of Health. And so what we did with this paper is we looked at purchases made for 422 kids in 2013 and 14 from areas of New York City and elsewhere, focusing on sort of the three largest fast food chains in New York City that looked at that had menu options that included kids' meals in particular. These were Burger King, McDonald's, and Wendy's. And as you heard from Dr. Angel, among our sample, about 35% of kids actually purchased a kids' combination meal overall. And what we did is we first looked at these meals and said which of them meet the criteria laid out in this proposed bill right now. And we found that essentially none of them did. 98% didn't meet the criteria for at least one of the standards that are proposed here. And then we looked at what would happen if the kids walked into the restaurant, they ordered the same thing that they did before, and suddenly the menus actually met these criteria, the children's meals actually met this criteria. And we looked at questions like, what would be the reduction in things like calories, sodium, and calories from fat? And we found that there would be real reductions, about 54 calories for kids that purchased these meals, for the 35% of kids that purchased these meals, and about a 10% reduction in sodium and a 10% reduction in calories from fat as well. So again, looking at this pretty narrow but we think important question of what would be the role of if this bill were implemented right now and kids making the same purchases, the reduction in overall calories, calories from fat and saturated fat, we think there's some real differences here that you could see. Is this a, you know, life-altering difference here? No, but I think in childhood obesity, anything right now that might have a real meaningful impact we're really looking for. So that's our overall sense of what might happen if this bill were to be implemented now.
That was amazing. Thank you.
Thank you for inviting me to testify at today's hearing regarding nutritional standards for distributing incentive items aimed at children. My name is Marie Bragg, and I'm an assistant professor in the Section for Health Choice Policy and Evaluation at the NYU School of Medicine with a joint appointment at the College of Global Public Health at NYU. Most of my research focuses on food marketing geared towards children, and so I'd like to share some research findings relevant to this proposal. So we heard a bit earlier some of the expenditures that food companies dedicate towards child-targeted marketing. And each year, companies spend $1.8 billion targeting young people with food advertisements. Most of the unhealthy products in these advertisements are targeted towards communities of color. And these sorts of advertisements have been shown to overwhelm parents' abilities to regulate the children's diet. They increase children's preferences for these products. They increase purchase requests for these products. And they lead children to overeat advertised products. And so one of the areas of focus of food policy research has been the use of targeted marketing. And we see that in communities of color, that there is heavier amounts of food marketing, and that in fast food restaurants specifically, food marketing is highly prevalent in inside food fast food restaurants. Also, Black and Latino adolescents and children see more advertisements for unhealthy product than their white peers. And importantly, there are numerous studies showing that cartoon characters, characters appealing to children, are heavily used in advertisements in supermarkets, on websites, and in fast food restaurants. Two research studies I want to highlight in particular focus on the use of incentives or characters in child-targeted marketing. One was a study conducted by researchers at Yale University where they asked preschool children to rate and taste foods. So if you could imagine, we had on this table packages of foods that had either Shrek or Dora the Explorer or Scooby-Doo stickers on them, and kids were asked to rate those the taste of those foods in those packages compared to food that didn't have characters on it. And preschool kids actually thought that the food tasted better when there was a character like Shrek on the package. They wanted the food more, they thought it tasted better if there was a cartoon character on it.
That's disturbing.
These are the same kinds of characters used in many incentive items in fast food restaurants. Another study in 2009 conducted by researchers at Stanford showed similar effects with the McDonald's logo. So again, preschool children were shown packages that either had a McDonald's logo or not, were asked to taste and rate the foods, and children thought that the foods actually tasted better when they had the McDonald's logo on them. This extended to snacks that weren't even sold at McDonald's, baby carrots, which goes to show the power of the logo, these cartoon characters, and child-targeted marketing. So Dr. Elbel already discussed the study that we published this past year related to the changes in calorie consumption and fat consumption. And so given the ties between child preferences and food-targeted marketing, we know this is an important area to address with these types of policies.
Thank you very much.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Dr. Kimberly Libman. I'm the Deputy Director for Prevention at the New York Academy of Medicine. On behalf of the New York Academy of Medicine, I'd like to thank Councilmember Johnson and Councilmember Kalos for bringing this bill forward and for the opportunity to testify today. We support Local Law 442 because it has the potential to positively impact health equity among New York City's children and prevent further escalation of our current epidemic of non-communicable diseases. The Academy was founded in 1847 to take on the critical health problems facing New York City at that time, and we continue to advance solutions that promote the health and well-being of people living in cities worldwide through active research, evaluation, education, and policy work. As the folks who have testified before me have already made it clear, food marketing increases children's demand for the foods promoted. Unfortunately, the majority of restaurant foods advertised to young people are high in fat and sugar, which contributes to obesity and poor health. The Academy supports this legislation because it will begin to rebalance this equation by setting the marketing prowess of the food industry to work, promoting healthy foods and dietary behavior to children in New York City. And by that marketing prowess, I want to specifically note the $866 million Dr. Angel had mentioned that goes to marketing sugar-sweetened beverages alone. This act amends the Administrative Code of New York City and sets nutritional standards for distributing purchasing incentives aimed at children and is an important step toward reducing childhood obesity and its persistent disparities in our city. In 2012, among all youth aged 12 to 19 in New York City, more than 25% were overweight or obese. New York City in the past has leveraged a coordinated effort against obesity, has been a national leader in policies to address the obesity epidemic, and in 2011 was able to demonstrate a significant decline in the overall prevalence of child obesity in New York City, an amazing feat for which we should all be proud. However, that decline hides some very real disparities between children who are white and of color, as well as between children who come from more substantial means and those who come from low-income backgrounds. The disparities in childhood obesity among youth in New York City become very real disparities in non-communicable diseases among adults. Consider that diabetes mortality is 2.7 times higher in high poverty than low poverty neighborhoods. National data suggests that there are also racial disparities in fast food consumption among children. This legislation is in line with the evidence-informed and internationally recognized best practice for preventing obesity and non-communicable diseases. This best practice is based on the premise that food policies to prevent obesity should aim to improve dietary behaviors by improving the availability, affordability, and very importantly here, the acceptability of healthy diets and decreasing the availability, affordability, and acceptability of unhealthy diets. A summary of the evidence from multiple systematic literature reviews finds that promotions have a direct effect on children's nutrition knowledge, preferences, purchasing behavior, consumption patterns, and diet-related health. Current marketing practice predominantly promotes low nutrition foods and beverages.
I need you to wrap up.
Okay. So I just want to state that, there's been some research demonstrating a happy meal effect that's already been mentioned here. I want to skip ahead to the evidence from San Francisco, where they've already implemented a similar policy. And there were two main findings from a pre and post evaluation of that policy. The study suggested that the food industry will respond quickly, that those quick responses can have significant impacts, as Dr. Elbel had mentioned. But it also noted the importance of closing what has been called the nominal fee loophole. And so I want to call attention to the effort that Councilmember Kalos has made to close that loophole. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, how are you? My name is Charles Platkin, and I'm the director of the New York City Food Policy Center at Hunter College. This is a severely abbreviated version of my written testimony that's been submitted. Good afternoon, and thank you to Chairman Corey Johnson and the members of the Committee on Health for the opportunity to speak with you about the proposed local law to amend the Administrative Code of the City of New York in relation to setting nutritional standards for distributing incentive items aimed at children. I congratulate Councilmember Kalos and the co-sponsors for their work, for the innovative thinking that went into proposing this bill, which seeks to better the health of the children in the City of New York. I'd like to urge the committee and the City Council to support this important legislation. I'm here on behalf of the New York City Food Policy Center at Hunter College, which I'm the director. The center was created in 2012 to develop collaborative, innovative, and evidence-based solutions to preventing diet-related diseases. And we thank the City Council and the Speaker's Office for the support of the center. Food marketing to children, and more specifically, using marketing incentives that encourage children to consume unhealthy, high-calorie, high-fat, high-sugar meals at fast food restaurants, is an issue of growing national and international public health concern. It's therefore natural and fitting for New York City to meaningfully address this issue through truly progressive legislation, especially given the city's history for righting social inequities and serving as a role model for other urban centers throughout the United States and beyond. In an extensive review of the research, the American Psychological Association concluded that most children under the age of 8 are unable to understand the persuasive intent of advertisements. Additionally, the research demonstrated that the product preferences affect children's product purchase requests, and that these requests in turn influence parents' purchasing decisions primarily through what is commonly known as a nag factor. In other words, this type of marketing is by definition exploitive, because young children don't have the capacity to understand that they are being manipulated to nag their parents or guardians to buy unhealthy food products. Researchers have documented this so-called nag factor and have shown that food companies even know what types and kinds of tantrums work best. Think about this. In 2009, according to a report from the Rudd Center for Food Policy and Obesity, the average child viewed 262 TV commercials that targeted them to go to local fast food outlets and participate in toy giveaways and other promotions. In fact, each year, the food industry spends hundreds of millions of dollars on powerful predatory marketing of unhealthy food products to children. For example, a 2014 McDonald's TV commercial with a Happy Meal giving away 14 toys, which was tied to the highest-grossing film, How to Train Your Dragon 2. As in all such advertising, the toy in the McDonald's campaign were primary incentives for the purchase of this unhealthy food. The campaign typified the trend towards tying fast food kids' meal premiums to popular movies and TV shows. The aim is always the same: enticing, engaging, and entertaining a young and vulnerable population into eating unhealthy fast food. One of a parent's most important jobs is to provide their children with healthy foods, but food marketing to children, including the use of toy giveaways and premiums, undermines this parental right and privilege. It's difficult enough getting children to eat healthy and diverse diet. However, targeting them by offering toy giveaways tied to unhealthy food gives the fast food industry an unfair advantage. The proposed law, if enacted, will send a message to our community, making it clear that the New York City Council cares about the health and welfare of our children and about their future as citizens of this great city.
Thank you, Doctor. So I have a few questions. So thank you for being here today, for coming to testify, this is not me saying it's not true, but this is not my area of expertise. So to come here today with research, I'm going to assume it's accurate. I'm sure people are going to testify after you who are probably going to say it's not accurate. Then it's going to be difficult to determine what's accurate and what's not accurate. But some of it actually just sort of makes sense on its face, that if in fact you use images that children are have some type of affinity for, whether it be Shrek or Tony the Tiger or Snap, Crackle, and Pop, whatever it is, these fictitious things that are made to try to get children to have some type of affinity towards it, what basically your research is showing is that that deliberate, repetitive marketing has a neurological impact that then draws children, and sometimes maybe even their families, to purchase that type of food, even though it's unhealthy food. And Dr. Bragg, I think you talked about the fact that even if it's not a fictitious character, if it's just the logo of a well-known brand, similar things happen here. I also want to be clear that, I don't know if Councilor Kalis agrees on this, I'm not looking to target or be punitive towards McDonald's here. I mean, I don't think it's fair to make them the sole culprit and the boogeyman in all of this. I think they have areas they can improve in, and I think they're probably the most well-known brand in America, so it's easy to target them. But there are plenty of large fast food restaurant companies that are behaving in similar ways. So is that really the sort of the, I don't mean to denigrate all the work that you did by trying to encapsulate it into that, but that's basically what you all are saying here, right?
And I'd like to just mention that studies like these have been conducted repeatedly over the last couple of decades, and so it's now in the dozens of studies capturing the amount of expenditures, capturing the impact on adult behavior, capturing the impact on child behavior. So it's not just one or two studies demonstrating it, it's a really robust, well-done set of studies demonstrating these effects.
Great. Did you have something, Doctor?
Just that I agree, and I think that is a good way of summarizing it. Basically, this is a vulnerable population that is being unfairly targeted, and this so-called nag factor is a real phenomenon, and it should be looked at and thought about, and it really helps to support what this committee has worked on.
So I want to make a comparison here, and this is not me trying to be hyperbolic or in any way to target fast food companies when I say this, because, you know, smoking is different, of course, than consuming French fries. We know that. I mean, both are bad in some ways, but smoking is a lot worse. But I think we learned, and what came up for me when you had mentioned your research, is what we saw that tobacco companies used to do with Joe Camel ads and trying to target young people to make it seem cool and hip and happening. And the Joe Camel would be in a tuxedo with a top hat on, smoking a cigarette. I mean, again, I'm not saying that fast food companies are the same as tobacco companies, but the marketing is sort of similar in trying to draw people in. Is that correct?
I think that's a great comparison.
And there's a study in Milbank Quarterly from 2009 written by Ken Warner, an expert in tobacco research, and Kelly Brennell, an expert in food policy research, drawing parallels to the marketing and different actions taken by both the tobacco industry and the food industry and how similar they are in ways and different as well. But that provides a good review of those two topics juxtaposed.
Great. I want to thank you all for being here today. I appreciate your testimony.
Thank you.
Did you have questions?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you didn't tell me. Okay, Councilmember Kalos.
Thank you for your testimony. Was your research funded by any fast food industry or restaurant association or other special interest?
No.
Was any of your research funded by me or the city council?
No.
Well, the Food Policy Center is funded by the City Council, but it has has funding from the City Council.
Okay,
but it doesn't sway our my opinion.
So our work is funded by the Federal National Institutes of Health and the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation.
Okay, so no industry is doing one. So there's no healthy food industry special interest saying we want you to do research on healthy food options. Thank you. So my first question is for Brian, thank you for doing the study. I think it's incredibly important that we actually make decisions in our city, whether it's Uber or fast food, following scientific research and study. And actually in the Uber situation, we learned that it wasn't what we thought it would be. So just to be clear, among your sample, 35% of the children ate children's combination meals that included a toy?
That's right.
And currently, 98% of the meals would not meet our nutrition criteria proposed by the bill?
That's right. That looked at exact purchases by these kids, and 98% didn't meet criteria. That's right.
Do you know how many did you look at the kids live well at all, or was that isolated?
No, we didn't look at that.
Thank you. And then one question I had is, it says, children whose purchases include such a meal would see a 9% reduction, and then it continues and then said there would be an overall 3% reduction in calories consumed by children at these restaurants regardless of purchase. What is what are you distinguishing?
Yeah, so the two distinctions there are among the 35% that actually ate a kid's combo meal, which this policy, at least as currently enacted, or currently considered, would actually impact. So it looks at those kids and then said, taking into account that almost two-thirds of the kids didn't purchase a combo meal, what would be the overall impact averaging over all those kids?
So this would actually impact kids not eating the combo meal?
It assumes that the kids not eating the combo meal are going to get exactly what they got before, and then just sort of takes that impact over and above everyone else.
Okay. The next question is for Kimberly Lebman from New York Academy of Medicine. You got cut off right before you were getting to the interesting stuff about what happened in San Francisco. So if you could spend 30 seconds or less just summarizing what happened in San Francisco, when they passed very similar legislation.
That's totally okay. Thank you. Sorry, so the legislation in San Francisco, the study there basically found that the food industry did not change their children's meals as a direct result or immediately following the city council's policy, but they did. It did happen sort of concurrently, and it seemed to encourage the industry to move in a direction of providing healthier children's meals in general. What we found, or what the researchers in California found, is that the industry also moved to make the toys or incentive items available for a nominal fee. In their case, it was 10 cents. And so what the Academy is suggesting is that the council, we want to commend you for including a clause in the bill to try and close that loophole on the nominal fee, but we think the language could be stronger and could be more specific in terms of defining what level of fee is considered nominal.
Do you have specific language you proposed?
I don't have specific language on that we've proposed.
You would consider amending your testimony to include the specific language? I'm very interested. My next question is for Dr. Marie Bragg. Thank you for compelling information. So one question, this might be speculative, but it seems like a lot of the things you're telling us about in terms of advertising and its impacts are things that you've researched, but it seems like a $1.8 billion investment in advertising would demonstrate that the industry believes your research.
In the fact that they spend so much money suggests in the business and you know, what they decide and is a good investment is not at all my area of expertise, but I think my own common sense suggests that if they're spending $1.8 billion on youth targeted marketing, they think something within it is working. And so the research that examines that has been consistent over time, and there have been a variety of outlets that have demonstrated child targeted marketing, but they hold on to their data, so we don't know of studies that they've done that might be similar to ours and what those outcomes were.
Who is they?
The food industry.
Okay. Is there any research out there that says spending $1.8 billion showing 4,700 food ads each year to children doesn't get them to buy the product?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay, and with regards to this seems to multiple of you have said that children are in a different place cognitively and they have different decision making. Has there been any studies with regards to what happens when an adult is shown 4,700 ads versus a child? Is there a different impact based on their cognitive ages?
Several studies conducted by Halford and Jennifer Harris have demonstrated that adults will overconsume in response to seeing food ads compared to a sample of adults that sees neutral ads, and that this is more prominent for unhealthy products as opposed to healthy products.
Thank you. Is there any question I didn't ask that I should have? Thank you very much for coming, and really the research you are doing will shape public health in our city, in our nation, and please keep up the great work.
Thank you all very much. Next up, we have Gerald Fernandez from McDonald's, Dr. Cindy Goody from McDonald's, Tony Herbert from the New York State Minority Restaurant and Nightlife Association, and Thomas Green from the Queens Chamber of Commerce. Yep, Councilor Kalis wants to read something into the record as folks come up.
Thank you. While we're waiting for the panel in opposition, I did want to take a moment to note that New York State Senator Gustavo Rivera has similar companion legislation in the state of New York. His full testimony has been entered into the record. I will read one paragraph from it. Senator Gustavo Rivera truly believes that to combat obesity, diabetes, and other health issues that are plaguing our youth, we must put forth policies that create an environment that encourages children to develop healthy habits. The goal of Councilmember Kalis's Healthy Happy Meals bill and my bill in the state Senate is the same, to allow children to make healthy food choices without
any misguided influence while holding restaurants accountable for the food they are advertising to children. This type of policy has proven to do both.
Thank you. So you may begin in whatever order you'd like. Just speak directly into the mic and make sure the red light is on. Go ahead, sir.
First, my name is Tony Herbert, community advocate Tony Herbert. I am the president and CEO of the New York State Minority Restaurant and Nightlife Association, although I sit here wearing three different hats. I'm also the vice president of USTEP USA, which is a national program, and also the chair of the African American International Chamber of Commerce. I thank you guys for this opportunity to offer up testimony. So let me say this by saying good afternoon again. I'll read my statement. My name is Tony Herbert. I am the president and CEO, as said, of the New York State Minority Restaurant and Nightlife Association. As such, I work to identify and advocate for small business owners in the restaurant and nightlife industries here in New York. I'm also a community activist based in Brooklyn. It is in this capacity that I've had the opportunity to work with McDonald's franchisees in New York City over the past year following an incident, which is well known, involving some young people at one of Brooklyn's locations. Since my introduction to these owners' operators, I've found them to be good, upstanding small business owners who are involved in their communities and want to do right by the people they serve each and every day. All over the city, young people congregate in McDonald's restaurants after school and on weekends. They use McDonald's as gathering places because they're warm and inviting. They offer a variety of menu options, which now include more and more healthier items. The other reason so many young people assemble in McDonald's restaurants, I believe, is the tremendous lack of city-sponsored recreational facilities available in all neighborhoods for our school children. If this committee or the city council really wanted to help our young people, it should invest in providing safe places for them to spend their time and energies positively and constructively. We have a responsibility as a society to nurture and foster these energies, to harness them for the good of these kids, and with no outlet for the future of our city, that is despair. At a time when crimes involving young people appear almost daily on our televisions, do we really need our elected officials to mandate what kind of toys quick service restaurants like McDonald's can give away? Or do we need our leaders to be providing hope and opportunity to the kids all over this city, some of whom are on one bad decision away from a lifetime of being behind bars or dead? The good men and women who own McDonald's restaurants employ thousands of our city's young people, minorities alike. Giving them that pride that comes with a job as well as opportunities for career training and advancement. To target these owners, operators, is nothing more than a hindrance to our community, an overreach of a city government that should instead be focusing on the most vital of our needs, the education and growth of our kids, and the health and safety of all our people. I ask this committee to focus on what's important, and please leave the toys alone. Thank you for your consideration and your time this afternoon.
Thank you, Mr. Herbert.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Councilman Johnson and the members of the Health Committee. My name is Tom Gretsch, and I'm Executive Director of the Queens Chamber of Commerce. I'm here today not just as the Director of the Queens Chamber of Commerce, but wholly and jointly representing all the other Chambers of Commerce of the City of New York, including the Brooklyn Chamber of Commerce, the Bronx Chamber of Commerce, Manhattan Chamber of Commerce, and the Staten Island Chamber of Commerce. Keeping residents healthy is a great objective, and we are pleased to see the city work to educate the public on what they can do to stay fit and eat right. Studies have shown that having a healthy workforce increases productivity, and many companies encourage their employees to be active and inform them of what they can do during the day to stay fit. The five chambers of commerce applaud these efforts, and we look forward to working with you to help educate the public on these initiatives. When it comes to introduction 0442, however, we believe it goes too far and puts an undue burden on small businesses. While McDonald's corporate headquarters are in Oak Brook, Illinois, over 90% of the McDonald's in New York City are locally owned franchisees. These are small to medium-sized businesses owned and operated by independent businessmen and women who live, raise families, and hire local residents, anchoring business corridors throughout the city. These franchises must develop their own business plan, are in charge of ensuring their own stores succeed. By passing intro 0442, it will impede small businesses that generate more than $100 million in sales taxes and more than $32 million in property taxes for the city of New York. Like any business, McDonald's has changed the way they operate. By working with organizations such as the Alliance for a Healthier Generation, co-founded by the American Heart Association, and the Council of Better Business Bureaus, they have changed the way they serve meals based on the latest nutritional information as well as customer feedback. McDonald's Happy Meals currently offer child-sized portions of an entree, a kid-sized fry, and a choice of low-fat yogurt, apple slices, and beverage choices that include milk and juice. Alternatively, McDonald's regular menu offers standard meals intended for older customers. This has resulted in healthier meals for all the McDonald's customers, and between 2013 and 2014, orders of fruit served as part of Happy Meals increased by nearly 50%. The toys offered with Happy Meals are only an incentive to purchase an appropriately sized and balanced meal for a child, and has no correlation with the health of the meal they're ordering. The five chambers of commerce respectfully request this introduction be voted down. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Greck.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Jerry Fernandez. I'm president and founder of MFHA, the Multicultural Food Service and Hospitality Alliance. For 20 years, we have been making the case for why the restaurant industry is a good place to work for people who look like me, people of color, people who come from low income, and in my case, a widowed family. I started as a dishwasher when I was in high school, and I spent most of my time in the dish room, and today I spend my time in the boardroom helping companies figure out the value of diversity and inclusion. How do we sell, market, and serve to customers of color in ways that are culturally responsible? How do we engage with the community in ways that helps build the businesses, help minority franchisees grow? And in every one of these instances, it's McDonald's who's been the leader with us. So I stand here as a father, as a grandfather, who regularly serves my grandkids a Happy Meal as a way to reward them for doing well in school. I raised three boys doing that. McDonald's is the leader, and I feel, listening to these proceedings, as if they've been targeted, as if they were the enemy. Our industry needs to do more. I work with the restaurant associations. We do need to do more. But McDonald's is the leader, and I really feel anger about the way that they've been targeted across this country. Maybe not particularly with this group, but across the country, McDonald's has been in the forefront. I also think that we have to remember that the government does not change behavior, people change behavior. When seatbelts changed, it was people's behavior that changed. It's not laws that are gonna change it. Our industry does a tremendous amount to move the needle, on these things around health, and our industry has made a move. We think that the marketplace will speak for this. I agree with what was said earlier, that small franchisees are gonna get hurt if there's too much regulation. And the role of government and industry working together, as has been suggested here today, is a really good idea. But unfortunately, we don't see enough of that. So I would like to remind all the people in the session here that the companies that are in the forefront of their industries ought to be in the forefront of solving and working in the communities. No company has done a better job, in my view, on advancing diversity, minority franchisee development, supplier development, and for women and people of color, and I'm proud to say that they've been a supporter of ours, and I'm happy to be here to support them today.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Goody.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Cynthia Goody, and I lead McDonald's Nutrition for McDonald's USA. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you. I've been on this journey with New York City, starting in July of 2011, with then City Council Member Leroy Comrie. At that time, I had a six-month-old. We're here 5 years later almost, and my child will turn five on Sunday. She eats a Happy Meal regularly. She's also active and fit. Let's talk about McDonald's. As one of the oldest and most recognized quick service restaurants in the world today, McDonald's has more than 14,000 locations in the US and 230 restaurants here in New York City. As a nutritionist, I'm here to speak not about the tremendous economic impacts of our restaurants, nor the strength of our supply chain, rather the great strides in nutrition over the past few years. It may have been a while since members of the committee may have had a Happy Meal, so I brought some with me today so you can see several combinations for you to see. Because, aha, here we go. My esteemed gentleman will assist as I spill the water, but that's okay, we're a restaurant company, we'll wipe it up. So let me show you what we have here. In one box, Jerry, we have a hamburger, a kid's fry, apple juice, and apple slices. My friend here, to my left will show you that we have a four-piece McNugget, kids fries, 1% low-fat, white milk, and apple slices. Quick quiz. Which one of these meals meets the proposed criteria for introduction 0442? Which meal? This meal or this meal?
We're not playing games.
All right.
Tell us.
We'll keep you. Okay. This one meets the criteria. This one does not meet the criteria. Imagine you have two children in the back seat. One wants this meal, one wants this meal. This child would get the toy. This child would get no toy at all. So let me refresh. As you may recall, in 2011, then City Council member, now State Senator Leroy Comrie, introduced legislation very similar to that being debated here today. His legislation sought to prohibit restaurants from distributing incentive items aimed at children. We worked with the council member on the rollout of significant changes to Happy Meals. As a result of our partnership, Councilmember Comrie later stood with executives from McDonald's in support of the substantial steps we've taken to provide balanced Happy Meal offerings. The proposal today links the sale of toys to caloric intake, fat, added sugar, and sodium. An overwhelming majority of McDonald's meals, much like the ones I've presented today, fall well below the suggested aggregate calorie count as proposed in this bill. In New York City, McDonald's serves 1 million meals per month. In New York City, the New York City public schools serve 5 million meals a month. Limiting kids' meals offered with a toy to a set of arbitrary nutrition standards could result in reducing the amount of fresh fruit, low-fat and fat-free dairy, and juice provided to children, and move customers, young customers, to choose options that will not include these nutritional and child-sized portion menu items. Here's why we're opposed to this proposal. Number one, the proposed criteria are not based on science or generally accepted nutrition standards. Number two, it could result in unintended consequences, driving kids to consume more calories and less produce and less dairy. Three, today, more than 95% of restaurants around the world offer fruit, vegetables, low-fat dairy as an option, Happy Meals. So we're already addressing the goals of this legislation by providing calorie-appropriate meals with low-fat dairy, low sugar, and low fruit options. We've worked very closely with external partners and subject matter experts to ensure that we are offering a nutritionally sound menu. And fifth and final, this proposal has limited impact and only applies to chain restaurants offering toys to kids.
I don't believe that's accurate, but we can talk more about that.
Okay. Here are more details. The U.S. Department of Agriculture mandates guidelines for nutritional value of public school lunches. These meals before you is well within the USDA's current acceptable range of school lunches, and most are lower than the sampling of some of the lunches consumed today in New York City public schools. I can tell you that we and others have researched targeted goals in the proposal and can find nothing from a federal agency or non-governmental organizations that these restrictions are linked to. The calories, the fats, the sodium are not aligned with government and or medical organizations, official recommendations, research, and science. McDonald's has worked diligently to become the industry leader through the evolution of our Happy Meals and related programs to promote produce, low-fat dairy to children, as well as the inclusion of nutrition and or active play messages in all advertisements directed to children. The most recent example of this is the added choice of cuties, Clementine, and Happy Meals, a fresh whole fruit offered again this year after having served 38 million pieces of fresh fruit while in season a year ago. We work closely with external partners and subject matter experts, such as the Alliance for a Healthier Generation, co-founded by the American Heart Association and the Council of Better Business Bureaus. We also have a Global Advisory Council on Nutrition and Well-being, as well collaborating with industry experts as well as internal experts to ensure we're offering a nutritionally sound meal. We will continue to positively evolve the offerings in the Happy Meal based on consumer feedback, nutrition experts, and science. And when we narrow that offering to something that is not appealing to customers, it creates unintended consequences of driving families to purchase meals for their kids off our regular menu, a menu that's intended for grown-ups. And these particular menu items, because of their difference in portion size, may not be well suited for children. For example, our Happy Meal bundle currently offers child-sized portions of an entree, a kid's fry, a choice of low-fat, reduced-sugar Go-Gurt, apple slices, or a cutie's clementine. Important, we only promote milk and juice as beverages for Happy Meal.
As of when?
As of the summer of 2014.
Thank you.
We only promote milk and juice as beverage choices for Happy Meal in our national advertising and on our menu boards. We've also removed antibiotic, the RBST, from our milk. Just as I mentioned, more than 95% of our restaurants around the world offer fruit, vegetables, or low-fat dairy as Happy Meal options. I know of no other restaurant that has our reach and drive to increase fruit and low-fat dairy choices in the meals of our youngest customers. Again, we've committed to offering, in the U.S., offering produce or low-fat dairy in every Happy Meal. Importantly, this year, 2016, we will achieve a key milestone of serving more than 2 billion sides of packaged apple slices and the low-fat, reduced-sugared Go-Gurt combined since 2012. Beginning again, again in January, Cuties Clementines are offered as a choice in Happy Meals as an a la carte menu item. We have been told by a council member that having a whole fruit in our Happy Meal will provide some of their New York City constituents, residents, their first chance to have a whole fruit. In addition, we've worked with our suppliers to reformulate our 1% low-fat chocolate milk to be fat-free chocolate milk, and recently added Go-Gurt low-fat strawberry yogurt as an additional side. Made exclusively for McDonald's, this Go-Gurt contains 25% less sugar than the leading kids yogurt and is a good source of vitamin D and calcium. And during the period of June 2014 until October of 2015, McDonald's served 232 million Go-Gurt tubes around the country. Since 2006, McDonald's has been a charter member of the Council of Better Business Bureau's Children, Food, and Beverage Advertising Initiative. This means, in McDonald's, in the United States, we only advertise Happy Meals to children that meet strict nutrition criteria for calories, saturated fat, sodium, and sugar. Since this time, our national Happy Meal advertisements have included produce and not soda. We have also made other nutritional enhancements to our children's favorite chicken McNuggets. A number of years ago, we reformulated the McNuggets to be made with all white meat, and since 2003, we reduced sodium by about 20%. Within 2 years, McDonald's USA will only source chicken that is raised without antibiotics that are important to human medicine. In a partnership with the Alliance for a Healthier Generation, McDonald's announced at the 2013 Clinton Global Initiative annual meeting held here in New York City a commitment to action to increase consumers' access to produce and dairy to help families and children make informed nutrition choices. Specifically, McDonald's committed to only promote and market water, milk, and juice in beverages as the beverage in Happy Meals on menu boards, in restaurants, external advertising, using the Happy Meal and other packaging innovations and designs to generate excitement for fruit, low-fat or reduced-fat dairy, or water options for kids. Also, dedicating the Happy Meal box or bag panels 4 times annually to communicate a fun nutrition or a children's well-being message, ensuring that that 100% of all national advertising directed to children included a fun nutrition or children's well-being message. In addition, this commitment also includes the option for consumers to substitute a side salad, fruit, or other produce for French fries in value meals. The Clinton Global Initiative commitment covers McDonald's top markets globally, representing more than 85% of McDonald's global sales, and spans through the year 2020. Year 1 progress was measured independently by a third-party economics firm, KeyBridge. and was released in 2015. The members of this committee have a copy of the executive summary of the report, and a couple of key areas of progress include: more customers are selecting 100% juice and milk. In the first 11 months since sodas were removed from the Happy Meal section of the menu board in the restaurant in 2014, milk and juice selections rose 9 points. Specifically, what that means is before the change, 37% of Happy Meal orders included milk or juice. After the change, Happy Meal orders included milk and juice increased to 46%. During the same time period, Happy Meal orders with soda decreased from 56% to 48%. Let me say that again. During the same period, Happy Meal orders with soda decreased from 56% to 48%. In sum, this contributed to serving 21 million additional milk jugs and juice boxes in Happy Meals and a la carte in the same time period. This proposal only applies to chain restaurants offering toys with kids' meals. It does not apply to all other restaurants in New York City serving foods to kids, and therefore will have a limited impact. For example, some nutritional experts feel that pizza is a major contributor to children's caloric intake, but this proposal will not apply to pizza chains because I'm unaware of any offering kids' meals with toys. This is not to say they aren't out there, but I do not know of any. Again, McDonald's has made significant strides in offering apples in every Happy Meal, as well as a choice of Cuties Clementine, low-fat Go-Gurt, choice of milk, fat-free chocolate milk, apple juice, and not advertising soda. We feel that this bill punishes McDonald's for doing the right thing, for working with leading nutritionists, world-leading non-governmental organizations, federal agencies, and a former New York City Council member to offer a balanced kids' meals that parents and kids are happy and excited to eat. McDonald's takes great pride in our food and our nutrition progress. We believe the path that this proposal is progressing is a mistake and will not achieve its desired goals. Limiting kids' meals offered with a toy or a set of arbitrary nutrition standards will result in reducing the amount of fruit, low-fat, or fat-free dairy and juice provided to children, and move young customers to choose options that will not include these nutritional and child portion projects. I ask that you do not move forward with this proposal. Thank you again.
Thank you, Dr. Goody. I hope you feel like you were heard.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
I wanted to give you the opportunity to read your entire testimony because I know a lot was said here today, and I wanted you to have the opportunity to respond. So I'm glad you're here. I learned a lot.
Thank you.
From your testimony. I just want to clear one thing up. It's my understanding, though Councilmember Kalos could correct me if I'm wrong, that this piece of legislation applies to all restaurants, not only chains. So I don't think that makes it any more palatable for you, but I just want to be clear that that's the case. So, I'll come out as someone who eats at McDonald's from time to time. Usually I don't feel good about myself afterwards because I look at those calorie counts and feel like, oh my God, why did I do that? But it does make a difference now that I see that I can substitute healthier options on the menu. That actually is meaningful to me that I have that choice. One of the points I made earlier with the health department was related to soda, sugary beverages. You spoke a lot about that in your testimony, that it's not being advertised. It's not on the menu boards for Happy Meals. Would you support eliminating soda, eliminating sugary drinks being sold with Happy Meals?
So it's a choice. Again, we don't advertise it. However, families and children have a choice of balanced beverage options at McDonald's. Water, 1% low-fat white milk, fat-free chocolate milk, and apple juice.
You didn't answer the question. Would you support eliminating that choice?
Again, we offer a choice.
I heard what you said. Would you support eliminating soda? Sounds like no, you wouldn't support that.
I think that you're putting words into my mouth, and so I thank you.
It's a yes or no question. Would you support eliminating soda from kids' meals?
No, it's a choice.
Okay. So what is, you're the chief nutritionist for McDonald's.
Yes.
So what is the dietary value of sugary drinks?
I'm not sure when you say dietary.
Are sugary drinks healthy for you? Drinking Coca-Cola loaded with sugar, is that healthy? Does that contribute to diabetes or other potential obesity-related problems?
I don't know that I want to get into the science.
Why
and,
not?
In the physiology here
Why
today.
Not?
Because sugar does not cause diabetes. I will answer the question in saying that, you know, this is choice of parents or adult caregivers. It's about balancing the diet and the context, the holistic diet. It's up to a parent whether they choose to offer soda to their child.
Doesn't the government get involved in things all the time? You know, we say that, it's up to a parent if they want to put a, it's not up to a parent if they want to put a seatbelt on their child when they're driving in a car. The government says this is a public health issue. You're exposing your child to potential danger by not doing that. So we regulate things all the time, even though there's choice involved. The point I'm trying to make is, and I'm someone, again, lots of coming out moments here today, I drink way too much Diet Coke. I feel bad about how much Diet Coke I consume. I go into a Diet Coke shame spiral most days because of how much Diet Coke I consume. It's Diet Coke, so it's better than regular Coke. But kids don't really have much of a choice. They see it, their parents give it to them, and we see that obesity rates are higher. There's no real nutritional value to sugary beverages. They're bad.
Depends on how much is consumed.
We could say that with anything, though, really, right?
It's calories.
It's calories. But
it's calories.
But
our body treats.
But nutritionists use terms such as like empty calories. You know, these are empty calories that don't really have any nutritional value. And I would say that sugary beverages are empty calories.
So it's the position of the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics that we want to look to the total diet. And everything eaten has calories, more or less. Calories a calorie, whether it's calories from fat, whether it's calories from protein, whether it's calories
All calories
from sugar.
Are created equal?
Technically, if they come from fat or protein or carbohydrate, which sugar is from, fat has more calories per gram than does the same than protein or carbohydrate. So we could talk
so should
about...
Should New York City not have regulated trans fats because it should have been parents' choice if they wanted to give their kids trans fats?
With much due respect, McDonald's adhered to the legislation proposed and
did
passed
you support
here.
It at the time?
Yes. You know? No artificial trans fats. We adhered to the legislation.
Okay. I mean, the point here, and I think you saw the council members that were present, mm-hmm. were pretty hard on the Department of Health in saying we want a plan to reduce childhood obesity in New York City and obesity generally. I have sort of more focused on the sugary drink aspect because I think it's an out of control problem and something we have to actually work on and regulate and do something about. We're seeing what happens with diabetes. We see what the costs are related to diabetes and public health. But, you know, as a nutritionist, it's just hard for me to hear that sugary drinks. I mean, the research is out there, the science is out there. It's not good for people to consume sugary drinks.
So to an earlier point made by Dr. Angel, and I'll say it differently, but it's the same sentiment. It's not about where you eat, but what and how much you choose to eat. If you're going to eat, move your feet. Energy in needs to be superseded or exceeded by energy, you know, expended through physical activity. And yeah, whether it's fat, whether it's sugar, whether it's protein, whether it's an excessive amount of food.
I can't cite it, and I could be wrong, and if I am, I apologize. But it's my understanding that there's research out there that shows that when you start to feed a child a certain type of food at a young age, it actually affects their taste buds. You know, neurologically, they then tend to become more attracted to a certain type of food. Maybe I eat from McDonald's from time to time now because my parents brought me to McDonald's a lot and ate a lot of Happy Meals growing up. That could be. I just think that that we have to be honest about what is actually hurting children and people in New York City and what the health impact is. And as I said before you testified, this is not really just about you guys. And I want to be clear about that. I mean, I'm not the author of the bill. I'm a prime sponsor. But I didn't write the legislation. But I don't think this is about, at least it's not my intention here today, to target McDonald's. When I talk about sugary drinks, I'm not just talking about you guys. I'm talking about all the chains. I'm talking about movie theaters where you can get basically a bucket of soda when you walk in. I'm talking about everyone. So I don't want to unfairly target you. And I think what you taught me today in your testimony is you guys have made some pretty incredible strides. Apple slices, clementines, sugar-free yogurt, decreasing advertising for soda and other related items to young people. So no one should take that credit away from you for voluntarily making those changes and adopting those practices where we've seen more consumption of healthy options. And I want to say that because this is not, I'm not here today to bash you or to attack you or to make you the poster child. I think it's easy to go after McDonald's because you guys are the most well-known brand, one of the most well-known brands in the entire world. But this is not just about McDonald's. It's about us being honest about the impact that sugary beverages, unhealthy foods have on public health in New York City, on disadvantaged and marginalized communities, on children, on poor people, and on folks who may not have access to fresh fruits and vegetables and other nutritional choices in their neighborhoods. And so I just want to say that it's not about targeting you. I'm glad you're here. I know this legislation would impact you, which is why you oppose it and why you gave us this information. But I want to say, just like it doesn't apply to only chain restaurants, it applies to all restaurants. This is not solely about McDonald's. I want to turn it over to Councilmember Kalos.
Sure. I think one of the panelists did not submit written testimony. Is that correct, sir? Did you submit written testimony? If I could have that. So my first question across the board, similar to the first panel, do you receive funding from McDonald's or its franchisees?
Yes, I do.
Sir?
Not presently, no.
So you have never received any funding from McDonald's, its franchisees, or any affiliates, or? Okay. Next question for everyone. Do you support a $15 minimum wage for fast food workers?
I'm not involved in the minimum wage discussion. We'd like to see higher wages whenever that can be worked out by legislation.
So as I said, I'm not a wage guy. I'm a jobs guy, an opportunities guy.
Yep.
So the wage issue is being addressed at the state level. Like most people, we'd like
and
to see
city
people.
And the city level.
Excuse me?
And the city level, and we just set minimum wage for all of our public employees.
We'd love to see a minimum wage, but it has to be balanced in ways that allow the franchisee to be successful.
Do you support $15 minimum wage?
I support what the state and city is going to pass as a reasonable wage.
We're aiming for $15. Next, McDonald's, do you support a $15 minimum wage for your workers?
We'll take that question and respond directly to you. I'm the nutritionist. Thank you for your question. As a nutritionist, we'll take that question back and respond to you. Thank
as
you.
A nutritionist, do you believe that if somebody earns $15 an hour instead of
$8 or $9 or $10 an hour that they will have more money to spend on healthy food?
It's unfair for me to speculate at this time. I'm unable to. I'm the chief nutritionist. It's
have you
nutrition
ever,
and...
Sure.
Thank you.
Next. Do you support a $15 minimum wage?
Not over the condensed time period which has been promulgated. I don't think having it go to $15 an hour over the very short term would be beneficial to lots of the business owners in our city, in our state, in our country.
How much funding does McDonald's and its franchisees currently devote to out-of-school programs in their local communities?
Again, that would be a question that we can take back to our corporate and respond to you.
Multiple folks have said that we need to invest in our out-of-school programming. The city council has put unprecedented levels into after-school programming with the mayor. So I'm curious about the, and I think one of the panelists who is no longer here was talking about the amount of investment. So what is the investment that was testified to?
I don't know about him, but I can speak on our behalf. McDonald's has supported our Showcase of the Stars, where we go into urban and inner city and talk to kids about career opportunities, what they need to do to get into college. And
but what about for health programming? The specific testimony on point saying that we need to do more for, I believe if you eat, you should move your feet. So what is McDonald's or franchisees doing in local communities to help give children a place other than McDonald's to congregate?
I can't speak for the franchisees. I can speak that the programs that we do, where we talk about all those things in schools across this country, McDonald's has been our largest and longest supporter.
Sure. Has McDonald's lobbied on this legislation?
We'll respond to that question separately.
So I think one of the folks...
What was your question?
I'm asking whether or not McDonald's has lobbied on this legislation.
What do you mean lobbied? On which legislation? On this legislation?
Yes.
We know they have.
Well, we know that. I'm hoping that McDonald's may have brought somebody in the room who engaged in that lobbying can answer that question, who's currently just looking at his phone. Okay. So I think that both of us could say that that there was lobbying. One of my questions is just why McDonald's has spent, I think since 2011, $526,000 lobbying, and whether it was on this legislation or the budget, and what the where those two overlap. If you could bring somebody up from McDonald's who can answer that question. Do you know why?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Sure, in the city of New York.
I'm just here to be speaking on the bill.
Sure, I'll get to it. But I guess one piece, as folks have been talking about why McDonald's, is Burger King's not here testifying or lobbying. Wendy's isn't, as far as I know. But McDonald's is here, and you're spending $526,000 lobbying in 2011 on McDonald's and 2012, 13, 14, 15 on budget. And so kind of curious about why there's so much opposition from McDonald's to this legislation, why it's worth $500,000. Could we get a response on how much you spent directly on this bill?
I mean, I'm at a loss here. We're opposed to this proposal because, as I've outlined already, it's not based on science or generally accepted nutrition standards.
Sure. So I guess it's just, I'm curious about how opposed. So I think it's $500,000 in New York City, and I'm curious about lobbying in San Francisco and anywhere else where this is going, and curious why you're so opposed to it.
Just if I may interject. You just said it's not based on science.
The proposed criteria here, not based on any sort of science or established standards.
But when I asked you a question earlier, you told me I don't want to get into the science.
I think it was in the context of type 2 diabetes, sugar being the cause of type 2 diabetes. That's what I meant.
Okay,
so just speaking to that, in your professional opinion as a nutritionist for the entire world that's watching today, does reducing sugar from a diet help prevent diabetes?
It may. It may help.
Oh, okay. So
Because there are genetic factors.
But so there's a link. So reducing sugar from a diet may help prevent diabetes.
May help to prevent diabetes.
Okay, and just so you know, the Department of Health and Human Services and other federal folks have come out pretty strongly saying that you want to prevent type 2 diabetes. Not having a good diet, consuming foods with high levels of sugar and added sugar, that is a good way. So, and along that, in terms of, you mentioned a lot about the feeling like we were only targeting fast food. You get that this is, you agree that this legislation targets all restaurants that serve children's meals with incentive items?
I would need to look at the introduction again, but so.
Sure. Would you support this? It seemed like both you and the Department of Health were talking about impact and incentive items versus non-incentive items. Would McDonald's support expanding it to folks like pizza places or whatnot that might have a children's menu and just dropping the incentive piece and just saying we're going to require certain health criteria for any children's meal?
Essentially, we do not support this proposal.
Would you support the proposal more if we decoupled it from incentives and just said any child's meal?
No.
Okay. And how much does McDonald's spend on advertising in the New York City market?
Again, I'm with nutrition rather than marketing from an advertising standpoint. Again, that would be something that we could...
Who is here with you from McDonald's? Who else is here with you today sitting in this room from McDonald's?
There are two people from McDonald's with me today. I'm not sure if they're here. They may have been departed, and they may have gone to the airport.
If you take a look behind you, and if you can tell me their names and titles.
What? Okay. So Ed Conklin is with me today, who's a McDonald's employee.
Do you know what his title is?
He's the senior director of the McDonald's Corporation.
Sure. Ed, would you please join us at the table? Perhaps you might have some of the answers to the questions.
I'm not going to speak on this
publicly. Say again?
I don't want to testify.
You're not authorized to speak for the public?
I'm here to support it.
Okay. So let the record reflect. So that the additional... employees are unable to speak in public, and many of our questions are continuing to go unanswered. So no knowledge of how much we're spending on advertising to children. Do you know how many children eat? So you were saying 1 million children, there are 1 million children's meals sold every month by McDonald's in the New York City market?
That is to my correct, yes.
Okay. Do you know how many of those meals include toys?
They all would include toys.
And do you know how many meals are being served to children that are adult meals that children are getting?
I have no idea.
Sure. Did you know that New York has a population of about 8.4 million?
I thought it was more than that, but okay.
8,491,079, according to the U.S. Census in 2014. And 21.6% of that is under 18, so we have 1.8 million children in our city, so at 12 million meals a year, that's actually 6 meals to every single child in our city. So would you acknowledge that that's quite an impact that McDonald's has in the New York City marketplace?
Our consumers tell us that they visit McDonald's twice a month, so that's two times of 90 meal occasions.
Last piece again, sorry.
Our customers tell us that they visit McDonald's twice a month.
Thank you. And in terms of it, you got to hear research from Brian Elbel about tying incentives. Do you agree with that? Were you here for that testimony?
I was here for that testimony.
And do you agree with that testimony?
I would have to review it again to provide further comment.
You've reviewed it before?
Have I reviewed it before?
The study that came out on your meals and coupling them together, have you reviewed that as a professional, as a nutritionist?
I've not. There's many studies that I've reviewed. I may have or I may not have reviewed it. I don't recall.
Sure. Mary Bragg gave testimony about advertising in children. Do you believe that testimony to be accurate?
There were two women who presented. I don't know which one was presented to.
She was the one who said that the marketing to children actually works. Do you believe that marketing to children works?
It depends on, it could be anything. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work.
Do you have research that shows that marketing Happy Meals to children doesn't work?
We have, there have been a number of times throughout my time with McDonald's where we've tried to look at vegetables as an example. You know, different ways of serving them. Our research suggests that children are not yet ready for McDonald's to provide them with vegetables.
You were just sharing that you have incredible results when it comes to milk and juice and changing from a default of soda. And you don't believe that we would have that same impact with whole fruit, clementines, things like that?
We do with fruit, with milk, juice, and water. Vegetables we've not yet cracked the code in.
And did McDonald's decision to start make these changes, was that a result of the introduction of this legislation here as well as the passage of similar legislation in San Francisco?
No, we looked to our customers to tell us what how we should go here in the context of championing children's well-being.
Did those
changes
follow the introduction of this legislation?
Some of them did. Some of them, we had other things that preceded this that were not predicated on the legislation.
I have a second round after you if you have any additional.
I don't have anything else.
Give me one moment. Let me just. So just, I think, couple questions wrapping up. Given high rates of childhood obesity and the emergence of type 2 diabetes among children in New York City, why are soda and other sugar-sweetened beverages still on kids' menus at the overwhelming majority of your locations?
We are not advertising in the Happy Meal section on our menu boards.
Yeah, no, I asked the question before, and she said that she believes it's a choice. And they're not advertising on advertising generally and on the menu boards.
So
external.
Burger King, Wendy's are participating in Kids Live Well. Why isn't McDonald's?
Because the Kids Live Well criteria preclude menu items that are cooked in oil.
So I have the Kids Live Well. Standards that are actually on their website. Do they have a different standard for you than they have publicly posted?
I'm not sure if they do, but they do not allow for foods that are cooked in oil. At least that's what they have told us when we engaged with them in July of 2011.
It's been almost 4 years, it's 5 years. You haven't come back. The coalition has grown to 155 restaurants. Will McDonald's join the Kids Live Well program?
Not to my knowledge at this time.
As a nutritionist, do you think it would be a good idea for you to join the rest of the industry and the National Restaurant Association as part of the Kids Live Well program?
We are part of a program that existed prior to the Kids Live Well program. This is the Council of Better Business Bureaus, Children's Food and Beverage Advertising Initiative. We've been a part of that since 2006 with consumer packaged good companies, as well as our competitor that you've mentioned. And there are certain nutrition criteria that meals must fulfill in order to be advertised to children under the age of 12. We're already a part of another program.
So Burger King thinks that this would be a good idea, 600 calories or less. Do you think McDonald's support having kids' meals with 600 calories or less?
We do already.
So that would be your default kids' meal? You wouldn't have any meals that exceed that?
No.
Okay, and 35% are calories from total fat or less?
but that's not part of the children's food and beverage advertising
initiative. Well, I'm talking about Kids Live Well, which 155 other fast food and other restaurants, including Wendy's, Burger King, Arby's. I mean, these are not the healthy. These aren't the places I think of when I want to go somewhere healthy. Applebee's, Boston Market, Bob Evans.
We're not interested. We're not interested in participating in the Kids Live Well program at this time.
Do you, as a nutritionist, do you believe that it's something worth doing? Do you think the other competitors are headed in the wrong track because they're sure? In light of the fact that children consume about 25% of their calories from restaurants and that childhood is a critical time for growth and development, how do you justify how out of sync your kids' meals are with expert recommendations for what kids should be eating during childhood?
I'm not sure where, can you repeat the question, please?
The rest of the industry, all the advocates, researchers, are all trying to push you in the right direction. How do you justify being so far out of sync with everyone else?
I'm not sure that we're out of sync in that we offer apples in every Happy Meal. We offer a kid-sized fry at 110 calories. We offer Cuties. We offer low-fat Go-Gurt. We've reformulated our chocolate milk. We offer apple juice. We offer water. And we don't advertise sodas on menu boards in our restaurants or in external advertising. We offer millions and billions. I mean, I've talked to the milestone of 2 billion servings of apples and yogurt.
I've got your testimony. I think just in closing, I've asked a lot of questions you did not give answers to. I expect an answer to myself and our co-sponsor and committee chair in the next 2 weeks.
Thank you, Councilmember Kalos. Thank you all for
being
here today. Okay, our last panel, Diana Torres Burgos from the National Hispanic Health Foundation, Robin Vitale from the American Heart Association, Michael Davoli, of course Michael, from the American Cancer Society, and Hazel Dukes from the NAACP.
Michael may have left. He was not feeling well. Yeah.
You may begin in whatever order you'd like. Just speak directly into the mic, introduce yourself, and make sure the red light is on. And Sarge, you've got 3 minutes on the clock. Thank you.
Hi, Chairman Johnson and members of the Health Committee, good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I'm Dr. Diana Torres Burgos, Advisor for Hispanic Health for the National Hispanic Health Foundation. The foundation is a nonprofit foundation that was established in 2005. Its mission is to improve the health of Hispanics and other underserved populations through research, education, and charitable activities. It's the philanthropic arm of the National Hispanic Medical Association, which represents the interests of over 50,000 licensed Hispanic physicians in the U.S. and is affiliated with the Robert Wagner Graduate School of Public Service at the New York University. The National Hispanic Health Foundation supports this proposal 442 regarding setting nutritional standards for distributing incentive items aimed at children because it can be a positive impact towards children's food choices and take a step towards reducing childhood obesity and prevent future chronic diseases. In our communities in New York and across the nation, the Hispanic, African American, and other poor children are the first generation in our nation due to the obesity epidemic that are projected by the CDC to suffer diabetes and renal failure in early adulthood and die before their parents. This can reverse, and we need to reverse this trend through prevention policies. Food marketing targeted children is a huge industry. In 2009, $341 million were spent on toys to distribute with children's meals. Studies have shown that food marketing targeted to children is successful in increasing children's preferences for foods advertised. A major problem is that the majority of those foods are unhealthy and they're high in sugar and fat, which are known contributors to childhood obesity. As we heard previously, a recent study evaluating the nutritional value of meals purchased at children at multiple fast food sites in New York City and New Jersey, of those children who ate a combination meal, and that is a main dish, side, and drink and toy, 98% of those meals would exceed nutritional standards for fat, sugar, and sodium. Another evaluation of children looking at meals in fast food chains found that only 33 out of 5,400 plus possible meals, less than 1% of all kids' meals combinations, met recommended nutrition standards. This is very concerning since, as was mentioned before, children are now eating more outside the home and have few healthy options in the restaurants. There is something encouraging, on the other hand. There was a study done looking at the impact of toy incentives on eating among children, and it showed that children were more likely to choose healthy meals when the toys were only offered with meals that met nutritional standards. And lastly, Hispanic and African American children are more highly targeted by the fast food and beverage marketers. Hispanic children have the highest prevalence of obesity at 17% compared to non-Hispanic white, 3.5%, African American, 11.3%, and Asian, 3.4% children. This is a significant risk factor for development of chronic disease in the population. This proposal provides a key opportunity that we cannot ignore to promote children's choices for healthier meals and reduce risk for childhood obesity and related diseases. Moreover, it could also provide a teaching moment for both the parent and the child to learn about healthy food choices and help guide the standardization of fast food restaurants in promoting healthier choices. We need to change the existing negative incentive we have for rewarding unhealthy eating into a positive one, one that incents healthy eating and food choices in our society. Thank you again for this opportunity to testify and for your attention to this very important issue.
Thank you. Thank you for being patient and for waiting to testify today. We really appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Robin.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Robin Vitale. I serve as Senior Director of Government Relations for the American Heart Association here in New York, and I have been very actively slicing and dicing my testimony really based upon the panels that went before us until the panel just prior. So I feel at this point I do have to defend the connection between diet and chronic disease. I was hoping not to, but for the good of the group, there is a connection between diet and chronic disease. Studies link eating out with obesity, higher amounts of body fat and higher BMIs, and increased consumption of fast food meals is associated with consuming more calories, fat, and saturated fat. The corollary between this increased consumption and the alarming rate of heart disease, stroke, diabetes, and other related diseases is apparent, and there are numerous studies that confirm that. So I would encourage you all to look at my testimony that outlines that in greater detail. We also mentioned in the opening panel with the health department around the good work that has been taking place here in the city. Currently, we have about 21% of our young people in New York that are labeled, unfortunately, as obese. While the study demonstrates a slight decrease in obesity for the city, the statistic is still far too high, and the study points to the need for continued public health intervention. Among other possibilities, PE being one that was referenced quite prolifically, the effort to improve access to healthy, nutritious food for children has to be a key target. This is not something that in and of itself is going to cure the obesity problem in New York City for our children, but it is part of the solution. We are just making it far too difficult for parents to provide appropriate meals to their children. Our schedules are busy, where it's very complicated to make sure that we are gathering around the table. It's you know, kind of that Pollyanna aspect from the 1970s where we all had dinners at home. That's not the reality anymore. More and more often, we see that we are dependent upon the restaurant industry to serve our families. Indeed, nearly half of all food dollars, about 48%, are spent on restaurant foods, which is up from 26% in 1970. Unfortunately, the majority of restaurants are serving our kids meals that are alarmingly poor in nutrition. We heard from the previous panel how some are making progress, but unfortunately, the industry's progress as a whole has been slow. Since 2008, the percentage of kids meals that met evidence-based nutrition standards increased from just 1% to 3%. For all these reasons and many more that are outlined in my written testimony, the American Heart Association supports the intention of the New York City Council to implement a requirement whereby any restaurant meal marketed to children should achieve the benchmark of nationally recognized evidence-based nutritional standards for both food and beverage items found on the children's menus. We do share some recommendations, which we go into at length in written form. Primarily, we would like to see the policy incorporate the RAND Corporation's performance standards for restaurants, as well as the healthy eating research recommendations for healthier beverages. We believe this will help with some of the implementation that was mentioned before. Additionally, we would also like to support that expansion of the focus, looking at all restaurant meals, making sure that anything that's marketed on a kid's menu is as healthy as possible. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Robin. And we'll look at your suggestions in your testimony. Thanks for being here. You, sir, are not Hazel Dukes, right?
Busted.
What's your name?
No, just I'm so not, we have Chair. My name is Barony Burke, and I thank the committee for the opportunity to read
oh, you're reading
Dr.
your testimony.
Dukes' testimony into
Great.
The record.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Hazel Dukes, and I am the president of the NAACP New York State Conference. The NAACP is the oldest, boldest, most effective, and most respected civil rights organization in the nation. The NAACP New York State Conference has played a pivotal role in moving the agenda for freedom and equality forward under the leadership of dynamic state conference presidents, each of whom addressed many critical issues during their tenure. As a direct consequence of the bill before you today, children across this city will be disproportionately denied the toys they love and the nutrition they need. Every day, young families rely on their neighborhood McDonald's to provide affordable, healthy menu options for their children. The Happy Meals offered today are not the Happy Meals offered, make you remember from your childhood. They have evolved to offer fruit and dairy options. More recently, McDonald's offered not only apple slices and also clementines as a Happy Meal option. And now, instead of soda, McDonald's only promotes milk, juice, or water as beverage options for Happy Meals. These healthy choices, among others, are what excites parents who bring their kids to McDonald's. The toys, which serves as a focal point for the children, encourage them to choose a healthy option offered in McDonald's Happy Meals. Some children in this city, especially many minorities in economically disadvantaged communities, have limited access to healthy food and toys. McDonald's offers both. Removing the toy will only deprive children of the enjoyment it provides. This bill is a misguided attempt to solve a nutrition crisis by unfairly targeting McDonald's, a key ally and a friend of children and minority communities around the city. Members of the committee, each one of you has a McDonald's in your district, and each one of these restaurants employ hundreds of people. Nationally, more than 60% of McDonald's crew members are either women or minorities. This legislation, aimed at hurting the bottom line of McDonald's franchises, will affect a large number of women and minority-owned businesses in New York City, not to mention the employees who have benefited from the skills and the opportunities for advancement that these jobs provide. Thank you for taking my comments into consideration today.
Thank you very much. Councilmember Kalos has some questions.
As I asked all the other panels, do any of you take money from special interests such as the fast food industry or McDonald's? I need you to say it into the record.
No.
No.
Sir?
As a person reading the testimony, I don't have any knowledge of that, sir.
The NAACP receives funding from McDonald's, I believe.
I don't have any knowledge.
No, I'm telling you, I do.
Oh, okay.
So I just wanted to make sure that the record reflect that. On the flip side, are there any healthy food special interests that are providing funding to your organizations?
We're funded through W. Kellogg for prevention of pediatric obesity.
Okay.
The American Heart Association does receive donations from a multitude of sources, many of which share our focus on healthy food policy.
Again, sir, I have no knowledge of that.
No worries.
The panel before you said that the standards set forth, whether it's in the Living Well program or in this legislation, are not based in science. If you could speak to that. Are the numbers we've set forth based in science? Is there any science to all this calorie counting and limitations on the amounts of fat?
I suppose I can take that question. There certainly is a tremendous amount of science. We've had the privilege of working with the sponsor as well as many other interested council champions on this issue. We have shared some of the criteria that we've loosely referenced in my verbal testimony and certainly outlined deeper in the written testimony. Whether it's connected into the Institute of Medicine or the RAND Corporation or the Healthy Eating Research, there's a lot of science and evidence behind the bill as it's currently drafted. And we also believe that there can be a greater alignment moving forward as we look at some possible changes.
With regard to possible changes, well, actually just with regards to San Francisco or others, have you heard of any issues with implementation and enforcement of legislation like this or similar?
So with the San Francisco enforcement from several years ago, I think the biggest concern was some of the loopholes that did exist, and kudos to your team and yourself and the championship in trying to close that loophole here. I think the Davis policy is perhaps too new to really think about the implementation aspect, but we're all quite excited for the potential of the health outcomes there.
So, and it also seems like DOHMH would support, or based on their testimony, seems to support removing the incentive item and just focusing on child meals. The panel of academics seem to indicate that children make decisions very differently. And then even McDonald's seem to be crying a foul to them being targeted with their toys versus just everyone. Do you have an opinion on whether we should expand from just toys to everything? To all children's meals?
So as I very quickly mentioned at the conclusion of my verbal testimony, but certainly outlined more deeply in the written version, we absolutely would be supportive of that focus. We think that there's a tremendous potential for the city to have a great impact on health. If you look at some of those restaurants that would not currently be targeted because they don't include incentives that are targeted at children, there's a lot of egregious examples of menu items that are on the kids' menu. So we think the potential is quite clear that the city could move forward in that direction.
All my questions. Thank you for sitting through a quite long hearing, and I'm incredibly disappointed by the fact that McDonald's didn't have any answers for us to any of our questions, including ones that involve things like science. Thank you to to my prime co-sponsor on this, Councilmember Johnson, as well as for chairing an absolutely amazing hearing.
Thank you all very much for being here. I appreciate everyone coming and testifying. I really appreciate you all being patient and sticking around, and we look forward to looking at your recommendations. With that, this hearing is adjourned.
That's all I can say. It was a long day.
It was a long day. A lot longer than I expected.
Are you based here?
Yeah, our office is in New York City.
Okay.
And but the NHMA office is in Washington, D.C.
I don't know if you saw, I literally was back there just crossing things out. I didn't even